morning, and welcome to another exciting broadcast day.
Yes, it's going to be 866-901-ADAM. 866-901-ADAM is the number to call. Ooh, so much to get to. Ironically, when you do that, wow, we got a lot of show, it usually means I can't think of anything to say right now. Oh, ton of show. Ton.
You say
show.
Another day, I say the dawn of a new day, a new world.
Wow.
That's right.
Who is that?
I'll tell you who it is. So, you know,
who is it?
No, your put downs no longer injure me.
I know.
Who are you speaking to? You're speaking to a world champion, my friend. Yeah, that's right.
It's amazing. Rachel Perry in New York. Rachel?
Are you talking to me?
Yep.
Oh, okay. No, just because.
Hold on a second. Wow. Yeah.
No, you don't understand. I was just trying to send someone an email because I was getting the show, and then I was getting the show on delay about 2 or 3 seconds later, like repeated. I was hearing everything twice, overlapped, and I didn't know which you to respond to.
But you responded to the first one, right?
Well, yeah, because I figured that. If it happened, if it happened, it happened first, not second. So
Right.
I didn't want to.
So it's the original, right? But even if you hear it twice, you can say yeah.
She can answer twice.
You know what
just
I
say
did
yes
this morning?
Twice. What's that?
I was so excited because I was like, wow, I can't believe like I'm in New York. I get to wake up and I went to Starbucks and like got myself a soy chai before I came to the show. I was like, wow, this is totally a novel thing. And
soy chai, by the way, is not only a warm beverage, but it's something you can pay extra for and get at most massage places.
Oh,
I like to finish with the soy chai. Is you mean you got to get out of your room? You got to get up and get out.
Yeah, I got to get up and get out. But the best part was, like, I was so excited about it. I got to the facility where I'm recording, where I'm broadcasting from today, and I sat down. I had my papers and everything. Went, where the hell's my soy chai?
You left it at Starbucks?
Of course I did.
You left $9 worth of coffee at the Starbucks?
Yeah.
Oh, that's brutal.
Meanwhile, I thought I also came up with this brilliant idea that we should all just move to London and we wouldn't have to start the show until 2 p.m.
That is a great idea because I've often said we're getting screwed over here in SoCal or over here on the West Coast because of that 3 hours. There's nothing worse, and it's nice when you're going the other direction. When the show travels to New York, you get to start at 9 a.m. But let's do it one better. Or maybe even Hawaii. Is Hawaii 4 hours off of us? Or is it back the other direction?
Well, it's back the other direction.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, but what time would that be? I mean,
well, if it's an hour the other direction, then we'd start at 5 a.m.
Wait a second.
Yeah, I got an idea. Here's what we do. Okay. We'll do the show for the East Coast. We'll take over the entire country. Okay. Then we'll move the show, once we get that in place, then we'll move the show to Hawaii. And instead of starting at 3 a.m., we'll start at 2 a.m., which is just like we're pulling an all-nighter. You know, we'll keep the party going. And then we'll just bask on the beach during the day. And then we'll do remotes from Hounslow, England, for no good reason. We'll work something up. Don't worry. Once we're having that kind of success, I'll sell the program directors on anything.
Yeah, I think if we were in Hawaii, though, we'd be starting at, like, midnight, which is also good.
I don't know how. I couldn't remember if it was an hour difference or 4 hours difference.
I think it's three.
I don't think it's the same as New York. I think there's another hour in there, but I can't figure out why.
There's gotta be a way to find this out.
We'll never know. Anyway, Rachel Perry, you are at your facility in New York, correct?
Yes, I am at my facility.
And you weren't at your facility on Friday, right? You were in your room?
No, I was at the facility Friday as well.
Oh, okay. And it somehow couldn't figure that out. And then did you do any Fashion Week stuff over the weekend?
Boy, did I.
What'd you do?
I went to a couple of fashion shows. I talked to some people. I have some interviews for you, but I'm not gonna give them to you today. It's a big day. I feel like today is Dave's day. Mm-hmm. In fact, I think we're gonna rename February 6th Dave's day.
No. There's no Dave in team.
No.
No, it's not about Dave Damashek today. It's about black and gold.
Mm-hmm. Dave sounds like crap.
I know. What happened? What was your schedule?
But I feel like gold, baby.
What was your schedule? What went on? You left here on Friday.
It's just a whirlwind.
Oh, Dave.
It's just
Are you talking to me or Dave?
Oh, I'm talking to Dave now.
Okay.
Well, you brought him up.
Yeah, I'd like to talk to Dave. I want to know. He sounds like crap. I want to know what happened. I must be thrilled.
I left a mortal man, tormented by so many past painful losses.
Yeah.
I returned a champion.
All four Super Bowl victories. It's going to be rough. Unlike that Seattle.
25 years.
All right. 25 years. True.
So the lights fantastic with the fellas.
You left here on Friday afternoon. You had a 12:30 flight.
I dispatched for the airport.
Right.
I jetted to the Motor City.
Yes.
I landed and tripped the lights fantastic in the surprisingly lovely city of Detroit.
You enjoyed it.
It was 50 degrees. It was unseasonably warm, apparently, all week long.
Mm-hmm.
That was the tale that was coming out of Detroit. But then I arrived, and cold came with me.
Mm.
A.K.A. cold weather, Steeler weather.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And so you brought Steeler weather with you, even though it was a dome, so it was sort of inconsequential, but symbolically, Steeler weather followed you.
The streets were lousy with Steeler fans.
I know. I heard it was about 90-10%
yes.
in the dome.
Correct.
Did you run into my friend Lori? Because she was there.
Yeah. Did you see Lori?
Yeah, I think so. Listen. Been a lot of tough years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thank you, Mike.
Yeah, a lot of hard years.
Painful losses for Coach Cower.
Mm-hmm.
The bus, a lot of miles, lot of miles on him.
Yeah. A
lot of wear and tear.
Yeah.
But now, Hines Ward, number 7, the bus, Coach Cower and the rest, and a young man named Dave Damashek, all world champions today.
Yeah.
And I say this, finally released from the torment. We've slain the beast named frustration. And now, like Patrick Swayze at the end of Ghost, the skies are opening and I'm ascending to the heavens.
Wow.
I bid you all good day. I stop by.
Wow, that's just, you drop down from the heavens to say hi.
I stop by and this is my final stop. And then for all
today,
of time,
Dave,
you will find me residing on Cloud 9.
Wow. And is it is there a cloud 10, by the way, or is that where it ends? You know what I mean? You don't hear people hanging out on cloud 3 and trying to make it to cloud 4.
If there is one, that's where I am.
Cloud 10.
Perhaps.
That's good. That's a good one. Where are you today? I'm on cloud 10. Wow, higher than cloud 9. And it's not like the Spinal Tap joke where this one goes to 11. It makes sense that the cloud chronology goes to 10. Why stop at 9?
Mm-hmm. When you're right, you're right.
Yeah, cloud 10, that's where Damashek is.
No, you could find me on cloud 7, too, if that's where I'll find Big Ben.
Cloud 10 would be a good name for your when you come out with your clothing line at some point. I don't know why. Just sounds gay enough to work. Cloud 10
all
clothing.
All black and gold.
All black and gold. Black and gold tuxedos with stripes down them. Black and gold swimsuits. Black and gold everything. Maternity wear. Cloud 10 by Dave Damashek. True Steeler fans.
Well,
write that down, Sheck.
Let me tell you one thing. Because I just don't want anyone waiting for it. There will be no apologies for the facts that for the fact that as the confetti fell from the Ford Field ceiling.
Tears fell as well. Wow.
Did you really cry?
Wow.
I'm not going to apologize to you.
He said there'd be no apologies.
I don't want an apology. I just want the truth.
He cried.
I made a vow.
Mm-hmm.
Did you kiss any strangers?
No. Listen, that's not what it's about. Coach Cower and I both had our detractors.
Yes.
People told us, you know what? You're not going to win the big one. You can't be there and win the big one.
Mm.
But Coach Cower and I had no one to lean on but each other.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
I heard there him during the press conference.
There were some lean times, some tough times.
He spoke about Shaq, and then I think he spoke about his family for a brief period after that. But mostly about Shaq. By the way, I'm looking at his Waldo through the glass. He's coming in here with a Super Bowl halftime review and a commercial review. He's wearing a Pennywise shirt. I'm guessing I may have given him that one, but I don't know. He may have been in them for a while. Talk to him. He'll tell you he was into early Pennywise, but isn't like the new direction they're heading.
Speaking of which, Tad, speaking of fashion, has decided to wear his black and gold, his Steeler jersey. Number one Steeler fan.
Oh, yeah. Well, you've been seeing him. You've been seeing him wear the Steeler jerseys all throughout the years. Yeah. Big Tad, when I first met Big Tad, was a huge Bulls fan. Now, was it? I'll give you a little quiz. Was he a huge Bulls fan because he comes?
He's a huge anything.
From that's a good point. Huge Bulls fan because of Chicago Bulls. That is because what city are you born and bred in, Big Tad?
Fullerton, Orange County,
because that's the cradle of Chicago sports fanatics, or because they were in the middle of winning four NBA championships.
Yeah, that was the main purpose of it.
Can I explain that to somebody though? Can I explain the sort of essence of fanship? You're not allowed to sit in whatever city you reside in, watch the TV, see which team is currently on a hot streak, and go out and buy their jersey and become their fan.
Yeah, I'll tell you what.
It doesn't work at all.
The phrase, there's no room left on the bandwagon, has never been more apt than Big Tad.
Hey, buddy, I wore this for you
today. The bandwagon is broken.
As you can tell, this is a Kevin Green jersey back from the day, okay? So,
yes.
I
have no beef with you. I have no beef with any man.
Oh, he has beef, though.
That's right. I've been cast in solid gold now. You know, let me tell you something. I feel like Frodo after the ring is destroyed at the end of Lord of the Rings.
Nerding. You
know? No.
Stress must have just been making you crazy up until now, Dave.
He hasn't slept.
You
may never sleep.
That's right.
Till about noon when you pass out driving home, hopefully. I am curious. You got out of here.
I'm glad you're here, Sam. It's finally over. That's how I feel. Like, I can see the Shire.
Here at the end of all things.
That's it. Wow. The ring is destroyed.
But let me ask this. The game was so much to talk about with Dave Damaschek because he just went through his Detroit City Odyssey with the Steelers. It's Friday night, you land, you hook up with Cousin Sal, Jimmy, and the likes. You have a good time.
Well, Sal, by the way, is a fun little side note. He has a new sport that he enjoys, which is...
Doing what to whom?
Well, the rental cars that they had, you know, Jimmy Kimmel Live was doing a week's worth of shows, which culminated last night in spectacular fashion.
The bus. I saw
the bus, Randall. P. Right. Diddy waving the terrible towel. Another longtime Steeler fan.
Huge, yeah.
P. Diddy, the face of the Steeler Nation.
Everyone close their eyes and picture P. Diddy and all the ads, all the spots, always wearing the black and gold. Sure.
Yeah, so, but Cousin Sal's new thing, because there were a few rented SUVs that were at the disposal of the staff, Sal took to running about 15 miles an hour into the bumpers of other SUV drivers.
No, actually other using staffers. The car as a weapon.
Right. Yes, driving into people repeatedly at stoplights and stop signs and everything. Yes.
Excellent.
Yes, he's now gone into vehicular crime now.
There was a time when he just used his own body as a battering ram. Now he's getting behind the wheel 6,000-pound automobiles and ramming them into others. But so you were at Kimmel's show last night. Which looked amazing. And how did they get Jerome in? Did they fly him in?
No.
Somebody said he was going to get in a helicopter and go over to...
Oh, no. It was 50 feet.
It was across the street.
Yeah, the theater was 50 feet. What a sight. They walked in their uniforms. Spikes on, still cleated.
Randall L. was still wearing spikes. Jerome had put the flip-flops on.
Yes.
But was still wearing the pants and the socks and the whole bit. Yeah, it was amazing. They didn't even get changed.
Yeah,
and Randall L. in cleats.
Yeah,
I
spoke with both of them. You know, I went up to each one of them. We shared them. I mean, our exchange is too private to share. I mean, that's confidential.
I understand.
But we shared them. We shared a moment, and I don't know. I'm not going to feel bad about it, like I already said. But I mean, we you know, we shared a couple of tears. And, sure. You know.
Is and then what time did you get on the plane in Detroit time last night?
Detroit time, it was 3:00 in the a.m.
3 a.m.
That's
which
right.
Which is 12:00.
Yeah, just got off the plane local time, 4:45, 5 a.m.
Wow.
Straight to the studio.
Wow.
But I needed no car.
And
I sailed here.
Wow.
I flew.
Sailing on cloud 10?
Yes.
Wow. Caitlin?
Yeah?
You're a Seattle fan?
I love the Seahawks.
Yeah. Sorry about yesterday.
Hey, you know, it happens.
Okay.
Do you see the difference?
Yeah.
They're not Steeler fans.
Right.
If it had gone the other way, we were going, well, it happens, you know.
No. Steeler fans.
So, whether it went the other way or not, you know, the Seahawks, they had a great season.
That's
you
true.
Know, they went that far.
Right.
You know,
this is what happens when you wake up every morning and you look out and you see the Puget Sound. This
wake
is what
up.
This is what it
I'm
does to you.
From
get
last
you get
night,
even-handed
you know?
About everything. Well, what are you gonna do?
See, she's still partying from last night. See,
yeah, you wouldn't be
the
partying.
The party ends when the final score
that's
goes
right.
against your team.
Caitlin, so you're upset, but you don't sound that upset.
I am not upset. You know, regardless whether we lost or not.
Yeah.
You know, it was a great game.
I don't want to correct you, but it's so. Irregardless.
Irregardless.
Thank you.
Okay.
You know, I used to kid about that, and I realize it's now catching on. Eventually, it will take over regardless. And we'll forget that we ever even said that just because I was screwing with people some years ago. You're okay, though, right, Caitlin?
Yeah.
Keep your chin up, baby.
Okay. Good times.
How
old are you?
I am almost 22.
Almost 22.
Almost 22.
So you've loved and lost with Seattle many times.
Yeah.
Foxy female, age 22.
All right. Foxy, very foxy.
Can,
still partying.
Name one quarterback from Seattle other than Hasselbeck.
Name one quarterback from Seattle other than Hasselbeck.
Oh, don't say it to your smart older boyfriend. I want to know from you.
I have a smart older boyfriend with me.
Well, then you're just chronologically older boyfriend. Is not quite
Foreman.
As well.
Foreman.
Who?
Foreman.
I think technically correct, but... In the twilight of his career, I believe. Warren Moon.
Warren Moon. Oh, okay. That was spoon-fed to you by the guy sitting in the passenger seat, though.
I say to all of Seattle,
please.
Keep your chins up,
can't
people.
Name one quarterback from the team she loves so much other than the one who played last night. That's not a fan.
Super fan.
We should have angry Seattle fans call in and try to knock Dave off cloud nine.
Impossible.
See if they can do it.
Well, if they knocked him off of his cloud, he would land on cloud nine because we've established he's on cloud 10.
I can't be touched any longer. Don't you understand? I'm like Kenobi when he said when he says to Vader. You know, if you strike me down, I shall become more powerful than you can possibly imagine. That's how I am now.
All right.
Don't hurt yourself yelling, Dave. Don't hurt yourself.
We will take ourselves a break. I want to hear more about your journey. Also, Def Rat Guy stopping by, going to tell us about his Super Bowl party. Ozzy's doing his reviews. We're doing our wallet experiment in Brooklyn, where Bruska says it'll never work.
Never.
Never.
We'll never
Let's
get it
see.
Back.
Some
is this
gambling?
Heaven?
Monday Night Football. Rachel is Rachel Perry in New York for Fashion Week, and we'll be right back after this.
You're listening to The Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM.
That's right. 866-901-ADAM. Def Rat Guy has joined us in studio.
What's up, bro?
What's happening, Jason?
We had a bad Super Bowl party that went off the hook.
You had a good time at the Super Bowl party? Was it at the frat house, at the house?
You know it, bro. Eight barrels, 3 tons of wings, hot, mild, and nuclear.
Wow. Oh, I had the super hot ones. Frat guy's, I think he's a Sammy. He's over at the Sammy house.
Dude, the nuclear wings were so hot. Josh Walsh got his stomach pumped.
Wow. You know, I used to hear a lot about stomach pumping, you know, in the 70s and 80s. You don't hear about getting it pumped so much anymore. Yeah. So are you a Sammy over at the Sammy house over there at SC? Okay, forget it. forget it.
Right,
hey,
at Adam.
Yes.
Adam.
Yes.
It just occurred to me that because I'm not there, Def Frat guy can't hear me.
Oh, so. Interesting.
Where's Rachel?
Yeah, you want me to? You want? I'll go ahead and tell. I don't even know why. Yeah, he wears the headphones, but I'm not sure why.
So, can you translate for me? Hi, Def Frat guy.
Rachel Perry says, "Hi, Def Frat guy. She's hot.
What's up? Where are you?
She's in New York.
Dude, she's hot. She looks like this girl, Ashley.
Which Ashley?
She tried that one.
Oh, nice.
But that you're not seeing. You're not seeing. You're not seeing the tried out.
No, not the tried out one. The one with the shaved down below.
Oh, okay. Well, they have something in common then, her and Rachel Perry. Rachel, anything else you'd like me to tell Def Rat guy?
Nah, not right now.
You're cool? All right.
Yeah.
So, you watched the Super Bowl?
The craziest thing happened. We were watching the halftime show, and I swear to God, Moose got wood watching Mick Jagger.
Oh, man, that is gay. You shouldn't let him off the hook for that.
He freaked out. We called him on it, and he freaked out and went over and got his potato gun and started nailing the SAE house.
Really?
The SAEs had to pay the price.
Wow.
No, Moose did because the SAE security guard came out and tased him.
Wow. I bet that killed this wood. Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Wow. Moose was out of control.
Oh, Ashley and Smitty broke up.
Oh, really?
Wait, now which Ashley is this one?
The tried out one, not the one shaved down below.
All right, so it's the one that looks like Misha Barton.
Yeah, the one that looks like an albino Misha Barton.
Wow, she broke up. Sad.
Did you get wild?
Well, I got pretty wasted. In fact, I woke up in the bathtub where we made the Jello shots.
Wow. That's a party.
Unless I get my stomach pumped, it's not really wasted for me.
Right. So it was, you were about 6 or 7 on the waste-o-meter, would you say?
Yeah. I had a pretty big buzz by the third quarter, but then I chilled out on the Jello shots and started just doing keg stands.
Good, man. So you're a fifth-year senior, I should say, over at USC, right? What's your major?
Right now, it's communications.
Uh-huh.
But I'm thinking about going to hotel and restaurant management. I think it would be pretty cool to be a concierge.
Yeah. Jordan?
Yeah?
You're a big Seahawks fan?
Definitely.
You want to try to knock Dave Damashek off Cloud 10?
Yeah, how much does it cost to bribe the officials at a Super Bowl?
Oh, wow.
Oh, that's
harsh words.
It's sad that's what it comes to.
Sad, yeah.
These calls are being called left and right.
Well,
completely against the Seahawks. It's ridiculous.
You know, here's the thing about most calls. Most calls could kind of go either way, and then the question is does it happen on big plays or not? You know, a lot of them are just a lot of holding calls. They could call holding on any play. Do they call it on a big play, or do they call it on a 3-yard gain? Or no, or an incompletion, you know what I mean? Seattle had the misfortune of having however many calls they've had against them during big plays. It just happened during big plays. It could have gone either way and happened during big plays. But the Matt Hasselbeck hitting low, the 15-yard penalty for him tackling the guy was not a bad call. It was a bizarre call. I have seen it called this year, and it's weird. But that was the most inexplicable call I've seen in Super Bowl history. And it would have been funny to show that to some old-timers, guys who played in the 60s and 70s. Like, you mean the quarterback lays out a DB? He goes low and upends a DB? There's a penalty being thrown? I don't want to live in this world.
Every tackle would be a penalty. Every time you tackle someone below the waist,
that was an inexplicable call. And a 15-yarder, not a 10-yarder.
That's ridiculous.
That was incredible.
The refs
are
terrible.
I agree. I thought the refs were particularly bad. Bad on this one. I think that this was a crazy play that they made.
Parker bursting one over the right side. They call him Fast Willie Parker. And Fast Willie Parker has just gone 75 yards for a touchdown.
Yeah, that was a terrible call, too.
Yeah, no call there.
Terrible call there.
Def Frat guy?
Jughead was so peeled at the refs. He threw a beer at the TV.
Uh-huh. Oh, really? Jughead's one of your frat buddies?
Yeah, he's a big Steelers fan.
Oh, he's a Steelers fan.
Yeah, but Buckethead, Steinberg, Josh Walsh, and Josh Blair were Seahawks fans.
The two Joshes were.
Josh Walsh and Josh Blair.
Mm-hmm. So after you're going to be graduating coming up here in a few months, right?
I'm only half a credit short, but part of me doesn't want to graduate.
Right, right. You want to? Yeah, it's hard to leave that. It's a fun life.
Hell yeah. Every night is off the Richter.
I got to tell you, even every night's a party. Even on weekends, after you get out of college, you don't do as many Jello shots. You really don't. You think you're going to keep doing Jello shots, but you really don't.
When I was a freshman, we called Jello shot night. It was really cool. Now I call it amateur night.
Oh, really? Wow. Rachel?
Yeah, you had Jello shots at your New Year's party.
Yeah, I did, didn't I?
Yeah, that was weird. Did anybody... They weren't cooked properly, and did anybody eat them?
I have no idea. Those were brought by Jimmy's cousin Ivy, I think, as sort of a joke.
Well, I brought cocktail weenies.
You talking about your two friends?
Yeah.
J-Man, speaking of parties, I mean, obviously the Super Bowl is just another excuse for you to get down. Now, how were the ladies last night?
They were pretty good. Unfortunately, the Omegas kind of roped in more chicks last night, but we're not totally bummed out. Mm-hmm. I mean, we had a couple of chicks there.
Did you watch the whole game with the crew in the living room?
Well, Scotty, Bubba, and Buckethead were down in the basement.
Mm-hmm.
And we were up there on the big screen, but we sort of got distracted when Josh Blair PO'd.
He got what?
He passed out.
Oh, he passed out. Oh, okay. I didn't know. And you didn't watch anything from your dorm room or from your room.
I actually watched the fourth quarter there because sometimes I get a little bummed out about my hearing.
Wow. I'm sorry to hear that. All right, well, let's just hang tight for a second. Nice. John?
Yeah.
You're out in Brooklyn.
That's right.
You're Jimmy Bresca's friend?
Yeah, long time.
Sorry. I've been friends with him for a short time, but it feels like a long time. John, we've people do that. It's like, I've known this guy for 3 months, but it feels like we went to high school together. I don't know if that's such a compliment. Yeah, I'd rather it be the other way around. You know, do the dating, do the math on it dating. You know, you don't want to say, I've been dating. They do that all the time. We've only been dating for 6 weeks, but it feels like we've known each other for 10 years. Yeah. So you guys aren't having sex and you're masturbating to other people. Like, I'd rather just feel like I knew everyone about the third time I met him. I like that. So here's the thing, John. We decided to do this experiment where you put your number on your wallet, on your cell phone, on your iPod, your MP3 player, and you throw it out somewhere in town. I think the phone will ring. I think if you put a thing on your wallet that says, if found, please call this number, the phone will ring. Jimmy Bresca, because he's from the mean streets of Brooklyn, said no way, no possible way, and would be angry if somebody did call, even if it was his wallet. You would verbally tear them a new one and then yell at them and then want your money back, right?
You added that part, but I would be surprised. I was surprised when people
returned. Right. We threw it out. We took intern Jerron. He hit the streets. He went north, south, east, and west. He threw the wallet on the sidewalk, and the phone rang five times.
Yeah.
Five times. We took a wallet, we put $100 cash in it, and the phone rang five times.
And the money came back every time.
That's right. So Bresca said this would never happen in his hometown of Brooklyn. So, John, you're in Brooklyn.
Yeah.
So you want to try this experiment?
Okay. Sounds good.
Where are you?
Right now, I'm in Canarsie. I'm on Flatlands Avenue. It's one part of Brooklyn. So.
All right. So find yourself what looks like a typical piece of sidewalk on a typical Brooklyn morning, and just throw the wallet down there. Now, you have a wallet. How much is in it?
$100,
and it has our phone number.
Yes.
Yeah. All right. No ID, just that. So we'll see if this experiment works in Brooklyn.
I say goodbye to $100. John, I'll send you a check tomorrow. Check's in the mail.
Thanks, John. Thanks for being our correspondent.
Yeah, Okay, no problem.
Throw the wallet down. Don't let anyone see you drop it. And then get in some sort of place where you can have a little surveillance over it and see what happens.
Okay.
All right, thanks, John.
I'll keep you guys up to date.
All right. All right. Def Rat Guy?
What's up, bro?
What'd you think of the halftime show?
It was off the hook. I mean, they looked really cool.
Right. Oh, yeah, you couldn't hear.
But I told you before what happened. Moose got wood.
That's right.
From watching Mick Jagger, and we're all like, dude, you better get out of here with that woody.
And he got tased by the security guy from the Sammy house?
Later on, because he busted out his potato gun. He was PO'd at us for calling him out on the wood.
Right, right.
He said he got it from thinking about a hot chick from Twydelt.
Okay. Well, I want to thank Def Rat Guy for stopping by. And Jason, or as he's known as, your handle at the house.
Maverick,
right.
He's going to come back later.
You're going to come back later?
Yeah.
Okay.
You said you would come and party down with us.
Yeah, I'll come by. That's awesome.
What a time that'll be. You're going to be a real hero at the frat house if you bring Ace Carolla with
you. Awesome.
I guarantee we'll rope in some chicks.
Okay. Let's take a break. Oswaldo's here. He's going to do his halftime review, also the commercial review from the Super Bowl. We got news, sports, ton of show. After this.
You're listening to the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM.
I understand everyone calling Jimmy Kimmel Jimmy Kimball. But Carolla, Adam Carolla.
You're awesome on The Office.
Thank you. Speaking of awesome, Oswaldo in studio. Oswaldo's sporting his Pennywise shirt. Big fan of Pennywise?
Yes, I do.
Yes, you do? Okay. Could you put your headphones on, Oswaldo? I don't want to mess up that beautifully coiffed hair, but there we go. That's it. Oswaldo?
Yes, good morning, Alan.
Good morning, Oswaldo. Did you watch the Super Bowl?
Yeah.
Couple things before we get to your review. John, our correspondent in Brooklyn, who's doing our wallet experiment, has an update for us. John?
Hey.
You said a woman picked up the wallet?
Listen, you're not going to believe this. About three or four people pass by. Then we see a lady kick it once or twice, bend down to tie a shoe, pick it up, follow her for about five blocks. Where does she go into? A check cashing place.
Oh, that's... wow.
I'm sitting right here on the corner of Flatlands and East 80th Street, and she's in a check cashing place right now. Well, look, this is hysterical. We picked the right one.
Yeah, cashing. I'm not sure if we're going to see that money again.
Scumbaggery abounds in Brooklyn.
Not shocked.
Wow, so cynical over there.
I think we were both right in some way.
Though. Rightfully so. Yeah, here's the thing. When I'm in charge, I'm going to turn every single one of those check cashing places into just a big government sting. Everyone who walks in the door, I'm just going
to
check them out. Yeah, I'm telling you, if you took every pawn shop and every check cashing place and just ran the license plate, if everyone had pulled up into one of those places or checked their ID, you'd find warrants all over the place. I really mean it. I believe there's certain... I'm going to do that. Another thing I'm going to do is just send my marshals to Alaska to go in there and find all the deadbeat dads and all the people that are over the IRS. I'm going to start spreading out Nevada, Alaska, and Florida and check cashing places, as well as turning all the junior colleges into minimum security prisons.
Oswaldo, I'm worried sick about Ozzy.
He's breathing hard into the...
I got a quick question. Should we have John wait a little bit and confront her, or what should we do?
No.
Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Oh, because I couldn't hear the guy on the phone, so I don't know what happened. I all I could hear during when apparently he was talking on the phone was Ozzy breathing.
He's a passionate man.
Yeah.
He knows
good
radio.
So what happened? Someone stole the wallet?
Well, they didn't steal it because we dropped it. So technically, I'm not gonna count it as stealing. But they picked it up and they started walking with it, and they walked into a check cashing place, which is a bad sign. Now, obviously, there's nothing for them to do with the wallet in the check cashing place since there was nothing but cash in there. Ooh, maybe it's one of those check cashing places where you give them cash and they give you a check. for people with super low self-esteem. I'm going to open that, see how much business we do. That'll be our whole angle. Oh, sure, there's one of these places where you take your check in and get cash. They're on every corner. What about the places that converts cash into checks? That's our market. Niche market. All right. We charge 15%, too. You give us $115, we'll give you a check for $100. And then you can go to the check cashing place. So I'm guessing that she's going to hang on to the money. It seems like she seems like the kind of person who needs it. That's all I'm saying. So. Although, as Waldo is honest as the day is long and has probably frequented a check cashing place or two in his day. Yes, Oswaldo?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Or the check cashing.
Yeah. Yeah, you've hammered a few of my checks there, right?
Yep.
Okay.
He's penny wise.
Yeah. All right. Hang on, John. We appreciate the update. Okay. Now we will get a little Super Bowl. And by the way, I hear we went to, we spared no expense to do a whole new intro song for you that is on the topic of the Super Bowl, right? Normally you do your movie reviews.
Movie review, yeah.
Right. This time you're going to do the halftime.
The halftime review will.
Right. All right. Well, let's hear our new theme song for Ozzy.
Oswaldo, tell us about the
Super Bowl halftime.
We want to know it.
Super Bowl halftime.
You have seen. Go ahead, Oswaldo, tell us.
Wow.
Good morning. Today I am reviewing the Super Bowl halftime show featuring the Rolling Stone.
Mm-hmm, the Rolling Stone.
The first song that the Rolling Stone sang was Start Me and Start Me Out. Very exciting with the tongue. The tongue part in stage started to move and the fan pulled it off.
They pulled it off.
Yeah, you know, the red make it to the tongue, you know.
Yeah, they make the big Rolling Stone mouth. Yeah, big tongue.
Yeah, I think I make a song.
Mm-hmm. Start Me Up.
Yeah. Start Me Up is the first song.
Mm-hmm.
It's a song that Moose, Jason's friend.
Oh, we got Wood, too. Yeah, Wood,
that frat guy's friend, right?
Yeah.
The last song, the Rolling Stone song, was Satisfaction. I'm very satisfaction. Jagger.
What was the last song?
Satisfaction.
Satisfaction?
Yes. Yep.
Okay.
Can't get no.
Can't get no Satisfaction? By the way, now it makes sense because you really can't get any sastification because
no,
it doesn't exist.
Impossible. Yes.
When is the last time any of us had any real sastification? Think about it. Never. Okay.
My Jagger started dancing and shaking his butt.
He did what?
Shaking, you know,
shaking.
The butt, you know.
And who is this?
Shaking his what?
Butt.
The butt.
His butt.
Oh.
Who did the shaking?
My Jagger.
Who?
My Jagger.
Mick?
Mac. My. Mike Jagger, yeah.
Mike Jagger. Okay. Here's, hold on a second. Let me just say. I now feel better. I used to just think Oswaldo couldn't pronounce my first name. I now realize he can't do his own. Mick. I don't know many, you know, there's different tongues, different languages, different dialects, different worlds. But Mick, I would imagine, would just be the, you know, it's not Antoine or Antonio or Hidalgo. You know, I mean, you might think that, well, Frenchmen might have some trouble with the word Hidalgo, for instance.
And Joaquin.
And Joaquin, right. Or something like that. And by the same token, maybe a man from a Latin country might have trouble with Pierre or some name like that. But Mick, isn't that one we could all do? Mick?
Seemingly straightforward.
Mick.
Yeah, for the pronunciation, it's
Mick.
Mick?
It's Mick Jagger.
Oh, there you go.
Mick Jagger. Yeah.
There we go.
Terrific.
There we go.
Never never in his 46 years heard the name Mick Jagger before, apparently. That seems unlikely.
Yeah.
I thought in the sec, you know, the stay very wonderful.
Uh-huh.
Good detail for the occasion. Mm. The stone looked and performed good for being so old.
Uh-huh. They did what?
The stone looked and performed, you know, good for being so old.
For being old.
Yeah.
I see. They look good for being old, and they perform well, too, yeah.
Yeah. All three of the song, the Rolling Stone song, very great. Very great.
Great?
Great, yeah.
Right.
My favorite song, you know, was Satisfaction.
Satisfaction, sure.
Yeah. The Super Bowl halftime show left the reviewer called.
Wow, left you called.
Say this, though. That Thank review you. Left me feeling a sense of sastification.
Me, too. Nothing more sastifying than hearing Oswaldo come in here and nail a review.
And that was Oswaldo's Super Bowl halftime review.
We hope you did not end up too confused. Oh, no, Oswaldo. No, Oswaldo. We don't know what you're
saying. And Mike Lynch, nice job. Didn't have much time to prepare the custom song, but you couldn't tell by listening to it.
Seamless.
Seamless.
All right, Oswaldo, nice job, my friend. You'll be back to review some of the commercials you saw the Super Bowl as well, yes?
A lot of commercial, very millionaire, you know?
Sure, I know. What did he say? Very what?
Millionaires. A lot of $1 million, you know?
$1 million. $1 million. Okay. And what is the lead singer of the Rolling Stones? What is his name?
Sastification.
Okay. Yes. Good job. We'll take a quick break.
Sastification.
We'll be back with Mick. Is it going to be an easier name than Mick? How many syllables in Mick? We'll take a quick break. We'll be back with news and sports after this.
You're listening to the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM. And do it right now.
Yeah. 866-901-ADAMS, the phone number. Dave Damashek's here. He's doing a little something called sports. I don't know if you guys heard, but the Steelers won yesterday. Rachel Perry is in New York City. She is there for Fashion Week. She made the scene this weekend. She'll give us a little report on that tomorrow, because today's kind of Sheck's day with the Steelers.
Oh.
He just got off the plane. He was in Detroit. He left at 3 a.m. last night and just got off the airplane.
Well, and I didn't sleep a wink because Sal was good enough to make sure I stayed awake by throwing cold cuts at me.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, that is sad. Yeah, Sal, here's what Sal does, Cousin Sal, Jimmy's Cousin Sal. All he does is figure out what you want to do and do the opposite, as he bases his entire life on that. He's like, you know what I mean? He has no agenda other than whatever your agenda is and then doing the polar opposite of that.
That's
he's,
right.
He's it's, like, you know, you ever play with your dog and the dog grabs hold of the chew toy? He's got one end of the little knotted rope and you got the other end. He's pulling. He's pulling. Now, if you turn around and change direction, he'll just pull the other direction. He's pulling whatever direction you're going. He's not trying to go anywhere. He's trying to go the opposite direction you are.
That's exactly right. He's sick. You know, he's this weekend on top of his obvious perpetual mental illness. But, you know, he's now got a cold with a hacking cough and everything. Really, he should be inclined to sleep. But he's so committed to torturing others that he throws that aside and throws cold cuts at 3:30 in the a.m. 30,000 feet in the sky.
And he's real. And as Jimmy Kimmel's star gets brighter, he becomes. You know, there was a time when Cousin Sal was just Sal. He wasn't anyone's cousin. No one heard of Jimmy Kimmel, in which case you would just immediately attack him or throw him off the plane. Now, he's like Uday and Kusei. He's one of the Hussein twins. I mean, he's really the emperor's son now. He can no longer be mandated by anybody, and he's spun out of control. All right, and I know it's unfair to Uday and Kusei to compare Cousin Sal to them, but it's the only one I could think of. May they rest in peace. All right, so Rachel Perry in New York for Fashion Week, and now it is time. Oh, we have a new song. We have a new song for Rachel?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, from Rich.
Oh, from Rich in Arizona?
Nice. Yeah.
Let's hear the new song then.
Hey, Rachel, don't feel so bad. Not everyone knows who Joe Montana is.
Right.
You may be a ditzy Canadian, but you have a hell of a beautiful butt. Hey, Rachel.
Rachel.
You didn't get those jokes, but you're still the one that I want to poke. Just make sure that you never lose your looks, 'cause you may end up as a fry cook.
That's not really likely. I don't know.
I liked it. I got to say, though, when, you know, obviously Jude one syllable and Rachel. Yeah, two syllables. Yeah, it's a tough. It's tough. You know, if your name was Pam, would have been better. But still, ballsy move. All right, Rich from Arizona. Let's get on now with Rachel Perry in the news.
Headlines, rapper Busta Rhymes' jewelry handler died after being shot at a video shoot in Brooklyn. Relatives of passengers who died in the Egyptian ferry disaster attacked the office of the ship's owner. Interracial fighting, and it cut me off any time because I know we're probably on a little delay.
Well, let me say this. First off, Busta has a jewelry wrangler. Like, you know, when he does his stuff, he hands over the jewelry to this person.
Well, as you should, because if you've ever put something down and then you lost it, you're like, why? Where was my wrangler?
Right. Yeah, like when I take my 18-carat medallion off that's the size of a Mercedes hubcap, like before we shoot some hoop or something, oftentimes it isn't where I left it.
You should put your phone number on it.
Yeah, I should put my little sticker on it. Yeah,
and make sure. You should just have a diamond chain and like have the medallion be your phone number.
Oh, better idea. All right, I'll write that down. All right, so he got shot, and is he alive? Is he dead?
No, he's gone. He's in the suite hereafter.
Sad. Up on cloud 10 with Shaq. All right.
Yeah. Well, I would say he's probably a notch down from where Dave Damashek is, actually.
Cloud 9, then. Still not bad. Still doing good.
A lot of death in the news this weekend. Relatives of passengers who died in the Egyptian ferry disaster attacked the office of the ship's owner. Interracial fighting at a maximum security L.A. County jail leaves one inmate dead. Four men are dead in Afghanistan as protests over the cartoon depictions of the Prophet Muhammad continue.
Yeah.
There's a worldwide man...
Good stuff, yeah.
Cartoons are funny.
Yeah.
They're so funny.
Once those marauding hordes hit the streets, they just start burning every building. They couldn't even figure out which one the Danish embassy was, so they just start burning every building on the block. There was a funny story where they trashed, I think it was the Danish embassy or some sort of official building. They trashed and set on fire each floor as they went up, and then eventually got trapped on the ninth floor because it set every other floor on fire and then had to be rescued by the people that were currently trying to contain them. And here's my deal. Hey, you're that much closer to Allah. Enjoy. If you break into a building and light every floor on fire on your way up to the penthouse, so say you. You're adios. There you go. Enjoy. You can think about what you've done at the top of the building as your handiwork, as the flames lick your body.
Oh, those cartoons couldn't possibly be as funny as all this, could they?
No.
Death. Burning.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
There's a worldwide manhunt for the Al-Qaeda mastermind behind the bombing of the USS Cole in 2000, which killed 17 sailors. Jaman al-Badawi, who was sentenced to death, escaped through a tunnel from a prison in Yemen.
Yemen.
Along with 22 others, 13 of which are convicted Al-Qaeda members.
Yeah. The whole tunnel has had a real renaissance. It was popular during Hogan's Heroes. There's a lot of tunneling. Obviously, a lot of tunneling going on in World War II, and then it went away. And in the last couple of weeks, it's back, my friend. Tunneling is the new black.
It was at its height, though. You're right, in WW2, as depicted in Victory, when Hatch, as played by Sly Stallone, leads a team of allied prisoners.
Him and Pele.
They were going to escape. The escape was all set, but at halftime, Michael Caine and company said, come on, Hatch, we can win this game. They were down 4-1 to the Nazis.
Yeah, the Nazis. I remember that.
And they came back, and Sly Stallone, a.k.a. Hatch, you know, he's inserted in goal. He makes a save on the Nazi sniper.
Yeah.
Yeah. And by the way, that's another one. Another escape picture from WW2. The Great Escape. I'll submit this. This movie everybody goes crazy for with Steve McQueen. It is a great picture and everything. But they call the movie The Great Escape. I submit, not so great. They all get killed.
Yeah.
What's so great?
I know. McQueen ends up back in the tank.
The poorly executed escape should be the title.
More aptly titled. Yes. Rachel?
Well, speaking of the Nazis, the Jacob Robita, the 18-year-old guy who was suspected of an attack in a Massachusetts gay bar, apparently, he was into the Nazis. He attacked and injured three people in a Massachusetts gay bar with a machete and gun. He was killed by police after a car chase and shootout in Arkansas.
Yeah. Robidoux was killed.
He killed a police officer after being pulled over. Mm. He was then chased for 20 miles before shooting his 33-year-old passenger, Jennifer Bailey, in the head and then opening fire on police, who then shot Robidoux twice in the head. He died in the hospital on Sunday.
Yeah. Good. Here's the thing. It's crazy that there's American Nazi Party. It's incredible that we have to keep going with this stuff. And here's the thing. Whether you're a Nazi or Wiccan or crazy born again or Shiite, whatever you are, let's just call you mentally unstable. Because here's the thing. When you're screwed up mentally, you just spin a wheel and whatever it lands on, that's what you're into. You know what I'm saying? You could be crazy into the Nazis, or you could be crazy into Wicca, or you could be crazy into PETA, or you could be born again, or you could be a crazy, you know, Jehovah. You could be down at the airport with your head shaved. You could be a crazy Steeler fan. It's just wherever the wheel stopped. Here's the deal. They're all crazy. And you know what's funny is we break them off. We deal with it topic by topic. Well, the Nazis, of course, I don't understand why, or the crazy KKK people, or the people that, you know, talk to Jesus Christ every day. They're all just nuts. It's like, whether you think you're Napoleon, or whether you think you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ and speak to him every day, or whether you think the Nazis were a dynamite group, you're just nuts. You're just nuts. You just picked a different team to root for. That's all. Let's just start treating them all as insane and getting rid of them. We need to cleanse this planet with people like this so they don't procreate. Thank you.
You're welcome. Hey, speaking of crazy, you know, finally, David LaChapelle has gone and talked about why... You know, he didn't do his show and everybody thought he was crazy. There was this whole conspiracy going
Dave
on.
Dave Chappelle.
David LaChapelle.
LaChapelle's a director.
The photographer, not the photographer. LaChapelle.
Didn't do a show.
Dave Chappelle. You're right. I'm sorry.
Dave Chappelle. All right.
I'm sorry.
You should be sorry for that one.
I left my coffee at Starbucks this morning.
And perhaps your head.
The coffee, the lack of coffee is responsible for the extra la.
Dave, and the David part confused me a little too.
She misses LA law.
Dave Chappelle was on Oprah talking about why he left Comedy Central.
Yeah, and you know it was funny because recently somebody told me about there was this big conspiracy that Oprah and all of these other famous black people were like forced Dave Chappelle to stop doing his show or something because blah, 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 whatever. Well, everybody said that he was, he was crazy or he didn't like being famous. Well, this is what he said about that.
All right. That's the thing that I always read that makes me mad. No, it was the fame. Couldn't stand the fame. I love being famous.
Yeah.
It's phenomenal. When I came out here and everybody was like, hooray, I was like, ow, back on TV.
Okay, so that's clear. It's not the fame. It's what?
It's the way the people around you position themselves around you to get in your pockets and in your mind.
Yeah.
That is infuriating to me.
All right, but that comes with fame, right? That's part of being famous. When you work unloading produce from trucks, you don't have a lot of hangers-on from the old neighborhood trying to get in your pocket, do you? Yeah, that's what fame is. You got to deal with it like Sheck has to every day.
You got any
every
people day. In your pockets, Adam?
I do. I got my posse right outside. I got Ozzy and Def Frat Guy. they're my posse, yeah.
And finally, speaking about your posse, and I know we've been investigating this, trying to find out the kind of people that go to fashion shows, because I'm here
at
Fashion Week.
Yes.
I have done some investigation. I just wanted to tell you who I ran into.
Who did you run into?
The Fashion Week.
Dave LaChapelle.
David. I don't want to correct you, Sheck, but David. Go ahead.
I'm such a dork.
That's all right.
That's all right, Rachel. Yes, you are. So I ran into, on Super Bowl Sunday, no less, David Alan Greer.
Dag?
Yes.
My main man, Dag, was there.
But Detroit's own.
Not during the game. Please tell me not during the game, dear Lord.
It was, no, he was rushing. I would have interviewed him, but he was rushing, and he was with his sexy Asian girlfriend, and I was rushing somewhere, and he was distracted trying to get into the Tracy Reese show, and it was about 2 o'clock in the afternoon, so no, he would have had time to get to a Super Bowl party after
right.
that.
Guys have figured out with this Fashion Week, it used to be, Like in high school, well, all the guys would go out for the sports teams and things like that. And then there'd be the one guy who got into the ballet or dance class. And you're like, hey, Fruitcake, what are you doing? What am I doing? I'm getting laid. You're hanging around with a bunch of sweaty guys that are 300 pounds. I'm hoisting hot 15-year-olds over my head. That's what I'm doing. This is what guys, straight guys, have figured out with these fashion shows over the last few years. Why let all the gay guys have fun? Why don't we just get in on some of the easy pickings? Bunch of coked-up chicks in from Poland. Skinny, can't fight.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
I couldn't tell if he was rushing or if he was just embarrassed that I saw him there and then I would tell you.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
Well, either way, you got the goods on him. Thank you,
yeah,
Rachel.
I did. Well, I'm Rachel Perry, and that's the news for now.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
Super Bowl 40 is through. The Pittsburgh Steelers defeat the Seattle Seahawks 21-10. Hines Ward is your MVP. A 26-year wait. But finally, the Steelers are back where they belong, atop the football world.
Cloud 10.
Yes, I'll get back to that in a moment. Quickly, other sports, a.k.a. moot point. They're rendered irrelevant for all of time. However, I will say this.
All of time.
L.A.'s favorite NBA team, the Clippers, took 2 overtimes, but they defeated Toronto yesterday. They're now 11 games over 500 for the first time since they became the Clippers. Kings of Schwartz and Ento, they whipped Utah. Pac-10 ball over the weekend. UCLA over Arizona. Wazoo over Washington. Arizona State over USC. Cal over Oregon. Stanford over OSU. Back to the football very quickly. The key play, as I say, Hines Ward, your MVP.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the key play in the fourth period.
The 43. Little toss. Here comes a gadget play. Randall L. He can throw. He was a quarterback in college. And he's thrown a touchdown to Hines Ward in the Super Bowl.
What game were they playing in again? Oh, the Super Bowl.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Let me just say something to you, and then I'll be through, and I'll hold my peace for at least another 23 seconds.
Right.
I just want to say this, though. Yeah, maybe on the radio you couldn't see, but of course anyone who watched the game, reverse, you know, the bus, and, you know, the pitch, and then Randall L., the QB, throws the deep ball to Hines Ward. This is in the fourth period of the Super Bowl, mind you. What a call.
Yeah.
What a thrill. What a, you know.
Yeah, exciting. Exciting game. And it was just, the first half was one of the more boring first halves I've ever seen in Super Bowl. But the teams got it together. But you just had that feeling. You couldn't believe that the Steelers went into the locker room ahead after that half.
And then fast, Willie broke it.
I announced to whoever's sitting next to me, they're going to get the ball first to start the second half. And they're going to score. And all of a sudden, this game will be over. A game that Seattle seemed like they were winning. All right.
Well,
Dave Damashek's number one sports.
By the way, I enjoyed that game sitting next to Miss Jessica Alba.
Really?
No.
As if I needed anything more to make the day special.
Did she seem to be a fan of anything or anyone?
Yes. Man named Dave Damashek.
Dave Damashek.
she didn't get to enjoy much of the game. She was lost in my eyes.
Too busy looking at you. Yeah. John?
Yeah.
Hey, Adam. Yeah, you're back. You're still in Brooklyn.
Yeah, I'm in a different part of Brooklyn. Totally different right now.
You're Jimmy Brusca's friend, our producer, who said that this wallet drop with the phone number and please return badge would never work in his hometown of Brooklyn. You dropped the wallet. Somebody picked it up and headed into a check cashing place. Do you have an update for us?
No call, no nothing. They're still online. The line is very big, but we left that and we drove and we're going down to sort of the Midwood area of Brooklyn. We're going to try to drop another wallet.
You got another wallet.
Yeah, we okay. got 2 more wallets, so I'll keep you up to date. I'll let you know what happens.
Thank you. Thank okay. you. All right. And like I said, when somebody picks up your wallet and heads into a check cashing place, it's probably not a good sign. Let's take ourselves a little break. Breska, what do we got coming up?
The U.S. Air Vice President is calling in.
When are we going to talk to her?
Actually, the next segment.
Oh, good.
Yeah. I want the Seattle mayor, too.
Oh, the
he has to answer for the bet we made.
We've put some calls in. We'll hopefully get him.
All right.
And Ozzy has a Super Bowl commercial review.
That's going to be great.
More from the Def Frat guy.
Perfect. They're both in my posse. Did you hear?
Yes. And Chris Hardwick's in studio.
Ah.
And David LaChapelle.
Yes. We'll take a quick break. Be right back after this.
This is Doug Savant from Desperate Housewives. Give Adam a call at 1-866-901-ADAM.
Yes, you should. 866-901-ADAM. Oswaldo and Def Frat Guy are waiting in the wings for round two. We, really, one of the reasons I wanted to do this radio show was to sort of correct some of societal ills. And I needed a platform. I needed a stump to preach from. We talked about ignoring the left turn, arrows. There's other things on my agenda, such as getting people to shake with their left hand instead of the right, ever since
Adam,
I found out. Yes.
Society is sick and you are the doctor.
That's right. I am. RX for ace.
What's with the left hand shaking?
Well, I started asking around and realized that 96% of society wipes their rear end with their right hand and doesn't wash your hands, and then I decided shaking with the left would probably be more pragmatic. How say
Donald,
you, Rachel Perry?
I say bow. I read one of Donald Trump's books, and he says that people should just bow to each other like the Asians do.
I agree, but why are you reading one of Donald Trump's books?
I was just curious.
Wow. You got a lot of time, baby. Do you wash...
this was a while ago.
Do you wipe with your right hand, Rachel?
Yes.
Yes, you do. Mike Lynch?
But I wash.
Right.
Right hand. Breska?
Right.
And
left.
Dave?
Left.
You wipe really? With left.
I'm lefty.
I'm a lefty, too, but I go right.
Is that right?
Yeah, you know why? I like to keep my left hand free in case there's trouble.
I see.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Throw some guy the forearm shiver.
Yeah.
I don't want to literally get caught in my pants down.
It's the most compromising position for most people.
You're never weaker.
You're not Adam Carolla.
In nature.
He's ready to strike.
In nature, you're never more vulnerable than when you're pinching a loaf. Mm. And if something should happen, and it rarely does.
But, almost never. But.
Almost never, but when it does, I'm ready. I am ready for action. And let me just say that to all the people that think about attacking me on the pot. Be prepared.
Because before
I
warning.
Am. Before
right.
warned, because I am. I'll be wiping with the right, keeping the good, strong left hand, my righting hand, ready. And then I come with the solid left haymaker, and then watch out for the right
and
hook.
And then you
that
finish
follows.
Your wiping with your victim.
I wipe the floor with my my fallen victim. All right,
and your tuchus.
So my tuchus. We okay. John's dropped a second. Wait, fall the second wallet. Wait a minute. Hold on 1 second. John.
Hey.
You dropped the second wallet in Brooklyn.
Dropped the second wallet. The guy snatched it up real quick after a few minutes of nobody walking by, took the money out of the wallet, looked at the wallet, put the money in his pocket, and put the wallet in his other pocket.
Very sad. This
Wow.
Well, this does explain
Breska. He didn't even leave the wallet. He took the wallet as well.
He took the wallet, put it in his other pocket. He put the money in his pants pocket, the wallet inside his jacket. We followed him for a couple of blocks, and he just took off into the crowd.
Wow.
I have one other thing. I think there's one, our last hope is maybe we can go to Bay Ridge, Brooklyn and see if somebody over there.
Why don't you go into the police station and drop it and see if we can get some of our money back, please. All right, thanks,
we'll get
John.
A wallet, but no money. Okay.
All right, well, Breska, I owe you an apology because
right.
you've been tainted by your environment.
I think we're both right. That's all.
Thank you. Okay, now, I don't know where I was, but I want to correct some of societal ills. One of the things I want to correct is on airplanes, I realize. I like to sleep on airplanes. Dave Damashek likes to sleep when he's not having provolone and pimento loaf tossed at him by Cousin Sal on an airplane. And one of the things that makes it difficult to sleep on an airplane is the ambient noise. Kids crying, people moving around, stewardesses pushing the carts. So I like to tune in and listen to a little classical music and fall asleep, but they don't have that on airplanes. They have a classical station. There's 14 stations. They have a classical one, but this blowhard interrupts every time. At least
This
is Elise Eberwein.
Very good.
Elise Eberwein is the Senior Vice President of Corporate Communications from U.S. Airways.
Good morning.
Good morning, and thanks for coming on our radio show. I flew U.S. Airways. I flew to North Carolina a couple of weeks ago, and I experienced on the plane the same thing I've experienced on every commercial flight, is not one of the 14 stations is made for people who would like to sleep. You have country, you have techno, you have whatever the movie or TV station is. You have one of everything, but there's not one that's just dedicated to people who might want to sleep on a plane, which is what 80% of people would like to do on a plane when it's a five-hour-plus flight. Why? Why is this? That's why we're calling.
How say you?
How right, say you?
Good question, and actually a really good suggestion. We have some 12 stations, and in fact, for February, we have a special station called Silly Love Songs in honor of Valentine's Day. But maybe something more along the new age with waterfalls.
Yes, yes. And by the way, I have nowhere to go around Valentine's Day. I'm from here, and my wife's here. I'm going to get on the plane just to hear the Silly Love Songs.
Are you okay? You can imagine that.
I'll take the flight to
the first one up on that channel.
Yes, I'll take the flight to Phoenix. I won't get off the plane. I'll just wait for the other people to board. I'll be sitting there with my headset on, happily laughing, and then I'll head back to LAX. But am I the first guy to think this or suggest this?
You're not the first person to make a suggestion. It's interesting. A couple years ago, we had someone write in who really wanted 80s songs. We had 70s, we had 90s. We didn't have an 80s channel, so we put together, you know, some Loverboy and
right.
some of the old 80s bands
right.
and called him and actually ran that channel 1 month
right.
and he was thrilled.
But Elise, I'm going to say this, and please try not to be insulted by what I say. Because
I work for an airline, so that you can't insult me.
And I know it's probably not your job, but if I owned an airline, my number one job I would love for everyone on the plane, including the pilot, to fall asleep. Yes, I say including, because that's how committed I am to this. I would love for everybody to fall asleep, like there was some golfer that had gotten a private jet. And Payne Stewart. Now, here's my point. Here's what I'm saying. If everybody on that plane goes to sleep, you no longer, especially in first class, you don't have to give away the free drinks. You can stop the meal service. You save a lot of money and a lot of hassle, don't you, if everyone just falls asleep on the flight?
I can't tell you how great that would be, just because you'd take away all of the crabby passengers,
right.
passengers that want to go in the lab and smoke, passengers want to fight with the flight attendants.
It would be nirvana. If you had an airline where everyone just went to sleep on your plane, it would be a windfall for your company.
Well, I like the concept of piping in some crickets, or maybe the rainstorm or the thunderstorm
right.
music, ocean sounds.
Again, without this is going to feel insulting, probably because it is, but out of all the airlines, nobody has come up with this idea. Nobody. Nobody. You have 30 airlines. They all have 14 stations. And nobody has figured out that we should have one with just some nice, relaxing, classical music so people could fall asleep. No, you got country and Western, but you don't have this station. It warps my mind. And frankly, it frightens me. How does this work? And if I owned stock in your company, I would be outraged. This, to me, is the height of stupidity.
Well, remember, this is the airline industry you're talking about, and I don't know if you've read the news, but we're not the most innovative, you know.
So you guys just basically saying we're stupid?
I'm not saying we're stupid. I'm just saying sometimes that we need a 2x4 on the head to
get
a creative
idea. For this one, this is a no-brainer. And here's the other thing, too. First off, I got. Oh man, do I have a lot to cover? First off, you know, you do it, and I think American does it, or maybe it's United. You do that when the stewardess does her thing, she goes, "No tampering with, disabling, or destroying the smoke detector." Do we need all three?
We do.
We're not covered with tampering. Tampering.
For our government, we need all three.
Yeah,
disabling's different than tampering.
No, it isn't. No, once you touch something, you've tampered with it.
I'm just thrilled to hear that you're listening to it.
I'm because I go insane every single flight. No tampering with, disabling, or destroying. Oh, I thought I had them.
Well, think about it. You
yeah.
can tamper with, but not destroy.
Now, listen. First off, no.
Yes,
no.
Okay,
no.
You can tamper with, but you can't destroy.
Look, if you say tamper, you've covered everything. I swear to God. Please. I was put on academic probation at L.A. Valley College. You understand that? And I know that tampering holds up in a court of law. What do you think I'm going to do? Hey, Your Honor, my client did not tamper with the smoke detector. He took a baseball bat to it.
Well, I'm going to focus my energy
really?
On
think that would work? Yeah, you're right. We got to throw out the case. I didn't know he ripped it off the wall and flushed it down the toilet. We said no tampering, not no destroying. Disabling, too.
No slapping and also no murdering.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Right. All right. So first off, do away with that. Secondly, the first class passengers, they should board the plane last. Why should I be on the plane for an extra hour? Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I know.
Everyone else's flight to North Carolina was 5 hours. Mine was 5.5 because I got to board first and then get banged in the shin by everyone in their Samsonite, get the stink eye for everyone heading into the cattle corral behind me.
The purpose of letting first class passengers come on first is so they have the overhead space and also so they can enjoy a cocktail or
enjoy a cocktail. There's an interesting one. You guys don't start serving until we're over Dallas Fort Worth. You don't serve on the ground.
That's not true.
Oh, untrue. Yes, Rachel.
You can just walk onto the plane last if you choose.
That's what I choose to do. That's what I do. And no, you cannot enjoy a cocktail on plane. I have many other topics to discuss. First, I would like airports to become international waters so I could have a cocktail. I was in North Carolina. I was flying home. It was Sunday. No booze until noon on Sunday in North Carolina. Well, I'm a businessman from Nancook. What the hell difference does that make to me? It's 3 days earlier and it's 4 a.m. to me. I want some booze before I get on the plane. I'm not flying the plane. I'm getting on the plane. How about that? How say you?
I say you should be in the house of the Lord on Sunday giving thanks and then getting on the plane later in the afternoon where you can have your cocktail.
Yeah, but I got a 10 o'clock flight out of North Carolina. And no, you don't get booze in first class on the ground. If you ask a stewardess, hey, how about a highball, sweetie? She will shoot you the stink eye and tell you you'll get it when we've reached cruising altitude. There's no way they're handing out cocktails.
Au contraire, we do an on-ground beverage service and you can get a cocktail on the ground.
Have fun trying. Have you flown your own airline?
I fly it often, okay. Although I don't drink on the ground.
Go to first class and see if you can get yourself a cocktail, number one. Number two, they were out of whatever they were out of when they got to me. That's the other thing in first class. If you sit at the end of first class and you're serving the salmon or they're serving the chicken, they'll be out of one of them. I want a discount for that.
Weren't you just happy to get a meal? I think there's plenty of places in the world where people would be happy just to have the meal.
Yeah, that's true, but they don't pay.
That one or the other.
That's a good point, but they don't have to pay $2,600 when the person sitting 10 feet behind them paid $300.
You're really not paying for the food, though. You're paying for the space, and you're paying to board first, and you're paying for the on-ground beverage.
Board first.
Get on the plane first.
We already covered that, didn't we?
Yeah, we did.
All right, hang on. If you can stomach this, because I want to focus back on the music part of this show.
She's
right?
Brassy, though.
She is.
I like it.
I like the cut of your jib. Unfortunately, you have no legs to stand on because boarding first means nothing. You get no cocktails on the ground. And being out of food when you've paid an extra 500% to fly in that thing is a slap in the face. Yes?
You don't agree. I don't think you're paying.
Let me ask you this. Then why have food at all? If that's not what you paid for,
you know,
why serve anything?
Food on airplanes because people are bored, and what do they want to do when they're bored?
They want to sleep. But you guys don't have an airline. You don't have a channel that'll accommodate them.
We're going to work on that.
All right, and you would argue again. You would argue that if your stewardess just said, "Do not tamper with the smoke detector," and I took a baseball bat to it, there's no court in the land that could convict me.
That's destroying.
Right, that's totally different than tampering.
It is.
100%.
Going up to play with it and try to turn it off so I can get a quick smoke, that's tampering.
Right, so
if I'm successful in turning it off, that's
right. So the other airlines that just say you can't tamper with it, they're playing with fire.
All the airlines say the same.
No, they don't.
Yeah, they do.
All right, I'm gonna look up tampering and disabling.
Let's get a poll going.
Hang on. Well, more arguments with Elise Eberwine from U.S. Airways. You don't pay for the food on first class. You should just be happy that you're getting fed. Yeah, I'd be happy if I was getting fed if I didn't pay. You understand? The extra $2,000. Wow. All right, we'll take a quick break. I'll be back to argue with Elise after this.
You're listening to The Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM.
Yes, you should. 866-901-ADAM. Elise Eberwine is on the line. She's here from U.S. Airways. She's the Senior Vice President in Corporate Communications. She's been good-natured because we've been getting into it a little bit, and she's hung tough, and I respect that. You're brassy. I like the cut of your jib. So far, I must say, your two arguments, one is in first class, you're lucky just to be in the air, so who cares where the food comes when you pay an extra 500%. I would say probably not a great argument. And the other one about tampering with, disabling, or destroying, whereas tampering wouldn't cover what would be done to the smoke detector, I also say would not hold up in court. I have you as 0 for 2, but there is something I think we can agree on. And that is the music. And I would like, here's what I've, you know, when the dust settles from this conversation, at least, ultimately, I would like you to have one station on your airline for people who would like to sleep. Now, the closest you currently have in your airline and every other airline is a classical station, which seems good because you put the classical station on the headphones and you immediately start dozing off. Enter Sandman.
Mm-hmm.
You just start relaxing. You just start the cares of the world drifting away. You're up on cloud 10 with Dave Damashek and the rest of the Steeler fans. And it's perfect. And just as you fall asleep and enter stage one of REM, this blowhard comes on the blower.
That, of course, was Air on the G String from Johann Sebastian Bach's Orchestral Suite in D.
Now I'm starting to wake up.
A four-part string orchestra.
Huh?
This brief movement, a gem of lyric melody, quiet counterpoint, and the masterful orchestration.
Guess I should get another free drink.
Of stewardess,
over here. I don't care what they call you. Just shake your ass and get over here.
Arrangement.
You top off this
flight
Bloody Mary.
I'm a flight attendant, not a stewardess.
Right. C.
Yeah, here we go.
The solo part fits comfortably on the G string, the lowest and darkest.
He actually goes on longer than the song.
Wilhelm called it Air.
Right.
The G string.
Because that's what I want when I fly.
Yeah. In the air.
That's right. Now the next song fires up. It's a classical. Right. Technically classical music. But John Philip Sousa and cannons going off in the background isn't great for sleeping either. All right. And then you hear this for about 6 minutes, and then Winchester comes back on and blows hard for another 10 minutes. So what happens is I start to doze off, and then I'm back up, and then I doze off, and then I'm back up, and then I realize, did I get on this plane for an education in classical music, or I just want to sleep while I fly over the red states? Do you know what I mean? Now, why wouldn't you just keep the classical going straight through? What's the deal with Winchester? You're paying that guy. You don't have a radio station. I have a radio station, ironically. You don't. You play. It's pre-recorded. You're not looking for advertisers to sign up, right?
We're trying to distract you from the fact that we only have salmon left. We don't have any chicken left this evening. We're at row 3
You know the
now.
Best way to distract me? Have me fall asleep.
You're
not
right.
Wake up irritated every 4 minutes. How about just playing this? And then go right into the next classical song without the long-winded description in between each one. And as I yell at you, I yell at all airlines. Nobody's thought of this?
I love your idea of a sleep station or something that's just soothing nonstop.
Why is it my idea? I know I'm not yelling at you. I'm yelling at my parents. I'm yelling at all humanity. But you have 14 stations that you get to craft yourself. You could have anything on them. And there's 100 airlines, and they've been around for 75 years, and nobody's come up with this idea?
You know, even you are entitled to have a brilliant suggestion once in a while, and I have to say, this is
right.
A good one.
Hey, Elise.
I'm reverting to blowing smoke now.
Thank you.
Let me say this to you, Elise. As Adam says, this goes out to all airlines. You have a golden opportunity here to be in on the ground floor, to be a trailblazer with this. I say unite with Adam Carolla before it's too late. Your career could be made on this move.
if this is what my career is going to be made on, I'm in trouble.
Well, what about it? What? How much do you think you guys could save if everyone or a higher percentage of people fell asleep on every one of your commercial flights? 20%, 25%? I mean, think of these savings if people just passed out.
Less complaining about my food choices and
available. That's right.
Less complaining about how long the safety briefing is.
That's right. That's right.
I'd love to eradicate all the complaining.
Right, with the very necessary tampering with, disabling, or destroying. Because tampering wouldn't cover it. How about it?
Great idea.
All right. Are you going to do it? Can you instigate it?
We're going to definitely look into it.
Make it so, Elise. Make it so.
Who would disagree with this? Just this. This is just playing. Turn it up, Mike. This is it. I can barely keep my eyes open.
Sorry, I fell asleep.
Yes, that's my point. Just all you have to do is take the existing tape, pull the John Philip Sousa marches out of it, replace it with this, and lose Winchester.
I'm thinking if we weren't such a sleep-deprived nation, though, we might stay awake and educate ourselves about classical music.
Yeah, it ends up costing you more because you have to hire the blowhard to do all the in-between stuff.
That's
listen
fair.
To this.
That's fair.
Okay, do it. Can you please?
Yeah.
Can we check back with you?
Yes.
All right, so. Yeah, I don't want this one. Makes me think the plane's on fire. I'm half asleep. I wouldn't hear this unless there's a hostage situation. Terror at 37,000 feet. That's what I hear when this fires up. All right, baby doll, you're a good sport.
All right.
And please, we're going to follow up with this.
No, that sounds good. I'm excited about your idea.
All right, that is, thank you. That is Elise Eberwein from U.S. Airways. Imagine that, just hearing this. Long flight, celebrating a Steelers victory.
I feel there's a very good chance that you've made some headway on this important cause. I really do.
Yeah, except for I screamed about it 5-6 years ago and nothing's happened. No airline, and they design all their stations. All pre-recorded.
I've got my fingers crossed.
It really makes you realize just how stupid people are. There was a time when I thought, well, there must be a reason, I just don't know about it. And that's how most people, that's every conversation I have with my wife, that's how it goes. I start ranting about something, and she says, well, look, I'm sure there's a good reason why, fill in the blank, I'm sure they know what they're doing just a little bit better than you do, and what makes you think, and I don't know, I'm not an expert in air travel, I don't work for the airlines, but I'm sure there's a reason why. As it turns out, there's no good reason why anything happens. Sad. All right. Chris Hardwick, our good old friend Chris Hardwick from, where's he from? MTV Singled Out and many other projects is in studio. We're going to bring him in a couple of few. We'll take a break. We got news. We got sports. We got everything after this.
You're listening to the new Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM.
That, of course, was Air on the G String from Johann Sebastian Bach's Orchestral Suite in D, scored for four-part string orchestra. This brief movement, gem of lyric melody, quiet counterpoint and the masterful orchestration, poetic sense of poignant inward feeling, was arranged for violin solo and piano arrangement in the German violinist August Wilhelm. Transposing C.
So have you freshen up this
comfortably
Dubonnet, huh?
G string, the lowest and darkest.
Sweetie, where's the button?
Violin. And thus, Wilhelm called
you're out of the salmon.
For the G.
I paid $2,600 for this goddamn flight.
Classics in the air.
Well, go find some salmon. Huh? Tails on fire? Yes, that's what it's like. Evidently, I'm the only one who's ever figured out that people would like to sleep when there's... Here's the deal. There's two things I know that airlines have not figured out. If your ass is going to be in the same position for 6 hours, there's two things you'd like to do. You would like to sleep, and you'd like to watch cable TV. Those are the two things. I don't know if I've ever sat upright for more than 45 minutes without watching a television set. I don't know if that's... I'd like to go back and sort of scroll through the backlog of my life and try to figure out if that's ever happened. It's never happened. Can you imagine? You know what would be torture for me? Adam, go park yourself on your sofa for 6 hours. No TV. Oh, here's a SkyMall catalog. I would kill myself. I would chomp down on a cyanide tablet like a Nazi war criminal. But on a plane, somehow it's fine. No problem there. I know JetBlue has figured out. After airlines have been around for 50 years, and cable TV or satellite TV's been around for 15, 20 years, but it only took one airline 6 months ago. They figured this out. The rest is just golf highlights, inexplicably. I don't know why. It's just people that fly love golf and NASCAR. Those are the two things they show. All right. Ozzy?
You can tell by the heavy breathing that Ozzy has joined us in the studio.
Yes. Oswaldo, the great Oswaldo, my Latin buddy. We've worked many years together, side by side, swinging hammers. I met Oswaldo about 16 years ago in a ventilator. Ozzy's a heavy breather. We were building a gym in Pasadena when I met Oswaldo. We became fast friends, and we've been close ever since. When I got the radio show, I thought he should do reviews for us because he paints a vivid picture. You know, this is theater of the mind, radio, and Oswaldo is he's a Renaissance man with the brush. Paints a beautiful picture. So I asked him if he could review not only movies, but review the commercials from the Super Bowl yesterday. We came up with a fresh new song, fresh new intro song. Let's hear it.
Oswaldo, tell us about some
Super Bowl commercials.
We want to know it.
Super Bowl commercials.
You have seen. Go ahead, Oswaldo, tell us.
Good morning, Alan. Again.
Good morning, Ozzy. Again.
I will now review the commercial from the Super Bowl.
All right.
As you know, the commercial are huge part in the Super Bowl.
They're what part?
Huge.
Huge?
Huge part.
They're used?
Yeah.
Okay. They're huge part of the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
Right.
They are very expensive.
Mm-hmm.
One of my favorite part commercial is the Budweiser commercial with the animal.
Yeah, that's funny.
Streaking during, you know, an animal football game.
Mm-hmm. Horses, I think they were.
Yeah.
Right.
Horses and cop, you know, and...
Yeah.
And chivos, meh.
Yeah.
what happened there?
I think
there?
He was talking about sheep. You're talking about sheep there?
Yeah, sheep too.
What did you
sheep.
Do this weekend?
Ozzy likes animals because it reminds him of barbecuing.
Mm. Yeah. All
Go
meat.
Ahead. Mm-hmm. Meat. Mm-hmm.
Another one in my favorite commercial is the FedEx Express, you know, the caveman.
The caveman. What happened? Commercial. But what happened in the Budweiser sheep commercial for those who didn't see it?
You know, the sheep, you know, the sheep shade nope. the ball, you know, saying, you know.
What?
Right.
Saying, you know, the Mick Jagger.
Mm-hmm. Mick Jagger?
Yeah.
What the?
That was Wait, that he was talking that about was sheep. It sounded like he was saying swear words. When he,
I know. No. Shave, you know, the bug, you know?
They shave the
yeah,
back.
Yeah, they shave, you know, Mick Jagger.
They sheared the sheep.
Yeah, the sheep.
All right. Do we have that one? Do we have a clip of that? So the horses are, the Clydesdales are lining up to play some ball, some yeah, football right. here. We've seen them in spots before. And now we have a streaker, essentially. Yeah, it was a funny one.
Funny one.
Yeah, because it's like the sheared sheep is a nude streaker. That's good stuff, Ozzy. Yeah.
Didn't need to see that.
What's the next one you enjoy?
The another is commercial, you know, I like the Federal Express, the Caveman.
Caveman.
Yeah, with the dinosaur and everything, you know, the prehistoric state, you know? Yeah.
Wow, ironically, prehistoric, the best word you've pronounced so far, the best pronunciation.
Yes.
Wonderful.
But he can't say satisfaction.
Satisfaction?
Yes. All right, so that's a commercial where they give the thing to the pterodactyl and it goes flying and gets smashed. Yeah, that was a funny one, too. A lot of cavemen, I should say, had quite a resurgence. It's right up there with tunneling. It's all back now.
Nothing with cavemen since Captain Caveman.
Well,
some 20 years ago.
They started doing this Geico caveman thing about 6 months ago, too.
Right.
Where they said even a Neanderthal can do it. Keep going, Ozzy.
Yeah. It's blitz.
Just a caveman one? The problem with this commercial is it's all subtitled, so it probably doesn't... We can all enjoy it as much as Steph Frat Guy did.
I like what Ozzy called for the clip. Point this one.
He did. All right. What else you got, Ozzy?
I also really like the Budweiser commercial, you know, where the fans in the stadium, you know, turn it...
In the where?
The fan, you know, in the stadium.
The stadium.
Yeah.
Right. That's our word. Turn that's over, stadium. You know, that's yeah. ours. Yeah.
Turn over the car, you know, for mm-hmm. making, you know, the bar of the Budweiser.
Mm-hmm.
They put the beer, you know, in the glass.
Mm-hmm.
And make it, you know, somebody drinking, you know, in three chat, you know.
Yeah. Yeah,
all
it was good.
Beer in the glass, you know, very good.
Yeah, it was good. They held the signs up in the stand. They made a Bud bottle, and then they whipped around. They did the wave. With the beer, and then they made a big glass, a big stein, and the water and the Bud all poured into it, and then they drank it. It was very, very creative. You like that one? Yeah,
I like it.
Mm-hmm. What else? Are we gonna play that? You want to hear what that sounds
like? A pouring sound.
Yeah.
Okay, the commercial I draw was the Mercedes-Benz commercial is what to sample for Mercedes-Benz.
No, the commercial you thought won the war.
Yeah.
What's the best?
No. It's not good.
It's no good. The worst.
Yes, the worst.
Yeah,
the worst, yeah.
Mercedes-Benz.
Mercedes-Benz, you know. For Mercedes-Benz, make it too simple, you know. Too
simple.
Yeah, too cheap.
Right.
Back on the sheep again.
So you're saying no sheep.
Cheaper.
Oh, okay. All right, so too cheap.
Yeah.
No good. What was that Mercedes commercial? I don't remember that one.
It's like I showed, you know, the new car, you know. I don't remember, you know. I don't put too much attention.
Yeah, it was bad.
Yeah.
Yeah, you rather focus on the positive.
Yeah.
While you guys are watching these commercials in the meantime, I'm sitting in Ford Field talking to Jessica Alba about what the Steelers need to do to make it a successful second half.
How say her?
She said, yay, Dave, whatever you say.
Wow.
That's what she said.
Lost in your eyes. Yeah.
Very lucky guy.
What else?
Thank you.
The very best commercial in the entire, you know, Super Bowl was the Bud Light commercial with the Big Bear. It is very good, man.
Bud Light?
Yeah, Bud Light.
With the Big Bird?
Yeah, the Big Bear.
Big Bird.
Big Bear.
Big Pittsburgh?
Big Bear.
Big Bird.
Yeah.
From a Sesame Street?
Yeah, no, it's for, you know, for the grizzly, you know.
The grizzly? Yeah. Oh, the Big Bear.
Big Bear, yeah.
Oh, the Big Bear, the grizzly bear.
You know, Tarzan English, you know?
Yeah, he's right.
Yeah.
Right, the grizzly bear is chasing the two campers, and the one guy. Yeah, here it is.
Save yourself!
Refreshingly smooth Bud Light.
What happened here? Worth it.
Well, first off, it's got to be nice for the friends and family of the guy who was eaten by the grizzly bear a few months back that they made the documentary Grizzly Bear about. It's got to be a little rough when you're the family. We're going to try to forget and watch the Super Bowl. Oh, yeah. There's a grizzly bear that is chasing a couple of guys, and the one guy offers him the beer. Beer in beer commercials, beer works on animals, it works on everything. Just you know, present the beer, and the bear is going to accept his peace offering, but his buddy snatches the beer, and now the bear attacks the guy. It's good stuff.
I see.
So you like that one?
Yeah, I like
it. You know, in general, the commercials were good. I was surprised. They're usually pretty lame and sappy. Also,
was there commercials for anything other than Diet Pepsi and Bud?
There was a couple of, like, dot-com-y things and a couple, like, job searchy things. Mm. And also, it was interesting that there were no Coke commercials, were there? The entire show? Did anyone see? A Coke can got crushed at some point when it was being the stand-in for the Pepsi can.
I have a question about that. How are they allowed to do that? Isn't that sort of using someone else's copyright? And you would think that Coke would be angry about that?
Yeah, I don't know how that works. I guess if it's falls under the heading of parody, you get to basically do whatever you want. But I know you couldn't play someone's song without paying for it, but you could show their product without paying for it, evidently. But, you know, I've said this for years. I never understood... Ozzy? Open your mouth. What's your brother? There you go. There. Keep it open. Thank you. You know, at $2.5 million for a 30-second spot, as a company, you could buy 35 distributing trucks, if you're Coke, for that price, fully paid for. No payments and insured for 10 years for that money. Or you could run a 30-second spot of a product that everyone is well aware of. I never understood the math. I assume they do it for Wall Street. I assume they do it for people that are investing and, you know, shareholders and that kind of thing. But in terms of Coke, well, Jimmy Kimmel loves Coke and Jimmy Kimmel hates Pepsi. And I know that because he took a sip of a Pepsi once thinking it was Coke and spit it at me when we were at a fast food joint, by the way, which is the man was 33 at the time, which it was interesting because he won't let Pepsi pass his palate.
You've just blown any future endorsements from Pepsi for Jimmy Kimmel.
He would not take it.
He would not do it. That's my point. If you like Coke, you like Coke. If you like Pepsi, you like Pepsi. We're not going to talk you out of it with Jay Moore playing your agent. So if you're Coke, fine. Let Pepsi, who did 5 or 6 spots, let them spend $14 million. $14 million, we'll open a new bottling plant in Indiana for that money.
I'm sure marketing people would tell me, would provide research to tell me I'm wrong, but I really don't think I've ever watched a commercial and thought, hey, that was funny. I got to drink their beer now.
No, all it is a sort of, you know what it is? It's like if you're a car company and you have a race team, all you do is lose money, but it's great when you fly the big wigs in to get to stand around the car, fly them to the races, go to the suites up top of the NASCAR, whatever. You don't make any money off it. You just, it's showing off, essentially. That's all it is. And then, you know, Oswaldo talks about it on this very powerful radio show.
The Pepsi commercial got panned in the New York Post, by the way.
Mm.
Just wow. Throwing that in there.
Are you, Ozzy, you good? You finished?
Yep. Nope.
No, wait a minute.
Super Bowl commercial.
Oh. Yep. We hope you did not end up too confused. Oh, no,
let him say it.
Don't you have your parting shot, Ozzy?
For me?
You have your last words, yes?
How did you feel about the commercials overall?
Yeah. You know, the end, the Super Bowl commercial left this reviewer cold.
Cold as that Bud Light he enjoyed so much. Wow. It left the reviewer cold. Let's see. Who do we have on? April?
Yeah?
Your company does music for airplanes?
Well, I was laid off from a company 2 years ago that does in-flight entertainment systems.
Mm-hmm.
So one division of the company created the content, and then the division that I worked for created the machinery and equipment and installed it on the planes.
Mm-hmm.
But I can tell you why, because you're wanting to know why.
Yes. Why the long-winded speech in between every classical song?
It is a revenue stream. If you listen to that Winchester guy before you tune out and fall asleep, eventually you'll hear him say something like, which is available on the hoity-toity collection, not currently on sale in our in-flight store.
That is true. It does happen sometimes, but it never started that way.
Well, that's the deal now. They're looking to pinch every possible penny that they can.
Right.
And they're making money on that. The company provide them the content are paying.
Right. I would argue they will make more money if I would just fall asleep and not order my fifth highball in as many minutes.
I would agree, but, you know, logic doesn't have a lot to do with it.
No, I do appreciate that inside information you provided for us, April.
Well, it's a business.
And do not kid yourself, people. It's a business. All right, wait a minute. Avani?
Yeah?
You found a wallet?
Yeah.
May we put you on the radio station?
Why?
Why?
Yeah.
Well, because you're a good Samaritan, and we'd like to thank you over the air.
Oh, you're welcome.
Yeah. Sorry.
Which station is this?
Well, we're out here in Los Angeles and other markets, but we're not on the East Coast. I'm out in Los Angeles right now. We just had a representative of the station drop the wallet in Brooklyn. That's where you are, correct?
Yes.
And you found the wallet and you picked it up because it had, if found, please call, and you called the phone number, right?
Yes.
How much
money? It has money in there.
How much money is in there?
Let me check.
About 100.
I don't even know.
Didn't even check. See,
Braska? I didn't even check.
What do you do for a living, Ivani?
I'm an artist and I teach kids.
Oh, wow.
$100.
What an example.
Million to one chance to get the artist who teaches kids.
Right.
I love it. I love what I do.
What do you do? What grade do you teach?
Pre-K, 4-year-old and 3 to 5-year-old.
You teach 3 and 5-year-olds?
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't have to teach them. You just have to wrangle them. You have to contain them. Stop eating that paste. It's not really teaching. All right. And what do you teach? Yeah, all you can do is sort of impart things, but you can't really
teach. I teach art. I teach mixed media, everything. They express themselves.
All right. So they dip their hand in a bucket of paint, just start smearing it around.
No, I discipline them. I teach them how to use a paintbrush, mix colors.
Wow. Nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
I have a good group of kids.
All right.
Very good.
What part of Brooklyn are you from?
Bay Ridge.
Ah.
Why?
Good
neighborhood.
Yeah, a little bit better neighborhood. Italiano.
Italians. Yeah.
Yeah, proud Italian, people. A lot of Greeks.
Yeah. What's your nationality, Ivani?
I'm Indian.
From
India, people. Not American Indian, from India.
Yeah. Do you know who I am?
No.
Do you know the name Adam Carolla?
Yes.
You do?
Yes. Ah. I'm sorry, I have a cold.
Bring up some phlegm there. Where do you know me from?
From the radio station.
From the radio station, but you don't get our radio station where you are.
No, I don't, but I used to live in L.A.
Okay.
I live in Rancho Cucamonga.
Wow.
Yeah.
Hold on, bring Ozzy in here and have him say Rancho Cucamonga for me. Please. Please, go get him. I'd like to hear Rancho Cucamonga have it. Well, nice job, Ivani.
No problem. Should I send you back?
There's probably somebody around there who will wrangle the wallet. He's a friend of our producer's, so hang on to that. You're doing the Lord's work. And take $20 out for yourself, Ivani.
No.
Look at that. So proud. Wow, this is interesting because Braska and I, producer of the show, got into an argument a few weeks back. I said if you drop a wallet, you put some money in it, but you put a please return sign on it, it will be returned. He says no. He says no one in my neighborhood would do it. We dropped it around here. I didn't think places got worse than Los Angeles, and we were 5 for 5. Now we dropped it twice.
No, 3 times.
Well, hold on. We dropped it twice in Brooklyn, and it was not returned.
Right.
The third time,
sorry,
we dropped it. It was returned, but it was from someone who formerly lived in Los Angeles. More specifically, Rancho Cucamonga. How say you, Ozzy?
This is Rancho Cucamonga?
Yeah. You better move there, Ozzy, because that is your town. One more time.
This is Rancho Cucamonga.
We don't have to say that this is fun. Give me one good Rancho Cucamonga.
Rancho Cucamonga.
Nice. Rancho.
Rancho Cucamonga.
Rancho.
All right.
Correcting me.
Interesting. All right. We need to take a break. Chris Hardwick is waiting for us in the wings. We'll talk to him after this.
Hey, this is Quagmire. Call Adam Carolla now at 1-866-901-ADAM.
Yes. 866-901-ADAM. Chris Hardwick is here. Dear friend.
Your name is the phone number. That's awesome.
Yeah, it's a coincidence. The overnight guy's name is Adam, too, and we just kept it going. Chris, I've known for many years. We met probably, we're MTV alum.
That's right.
Met him during the height of his fame over on Singled Out on MTV.
The brief flash. It was like flash paper.
Tell you, MTV, speaking as someone who was on MTV, it's really weird what it can do, and I'm sure nobody knows this better than you. I don't know what their ratings are. It's no higher than any other cable show. I mean, we used to do Loveline. We just get a 1.
Right.
Which is pretty good by today's standards, but probably not great 5 years or whatever it was ago. But you just get this 1, but everyone knew who you were. Which is weird, you know. Can you explain that?
Kind of ties into what you were talking about before with the company that sponsors the race car. Mm-hmm. You're like, why did it just somehow they manage to create an awareness?
Yes.
And even though people don't necessarily watch, they're aware of it. Somehow it leaks into the back of your head.
Right.
And it's just about branding, and they managed to. How can we make MTV sound any more boring? Well, it's about branding and marketing strategies. And
right. Here's what I want to know, though. You came to prominence on Singled Out as the host of Singled Out.
Sort of.
Jenny McCarthy, Carmen Electra. Did you bed either or both of them?
That's the first time anyone's ever asked me that. No. No. Had a very sisterly relationship with Jenny and Carmen. She was very nice, but we didn't hang out that much.
That's a double shame.
I apologize that I didn't.
His phallus was occupied. There was no room on it. You understand?
Is that right?
Let me explain what Chris Hardwick's phallus was like in 1994 when I met him. You ever see those horses that run off a quarter out in front of the supermarket?
Yeah,
with a line of kids waiting to get on? That was replaced the horse with his phallus and replaced the line of kids with a bevy of 18-year-old plus beauties. And now,
comedic metaphor may not actually be true.
That's right.
Well, mazel tov if it's even close to true.
No, yeah. Are you kidding? I was just this geeky kid that was around all these frat-like people that I didn't really like in college, and so I was very uncomfortable the whole time.
Well, how did it all come about? And then we'll get to Rock of Ages, which is Chris's latest project. It's a live on stage tribute to 80s hair bands.
That's right.
And are you singing in it?
I am, actually. I am.
What? We will get to that.
Okay.
But I do want to figure out, because I still don't know how the whole thing began for you.
It's a dramatically undramatic tale. I was in college studying philosophy, and I just got this job doing a show called Trash on MTV, which was very short-lived.
Yeah.
Like, every few years, MTV tries, they always tried to sort of recapture the remote control magic.
Right.
So we did the show called Trash, and it was, but the writing staff was unbelievable. It was like, Brian Posehn and Doug Benson, Joel Hodgson from Mystery Science Theater, and all these people who are on SNL now, and Jeanine Garofalo, David Cross. And the show lasted for maybe 3 months, but the MTV said, why don't you stick around? And then so they just forced me into the round hole of Singled Out.
And Singled Out, as I think about it, I just see beautiful people sort of running around and cheering. I can't even really remember the format, even though it was just a dating.
I don't really remember either. There was a lot of people rhyming their name with their genitals, I remember, and shaking soda in their pants, and then that was pretty much all I remember up to now.
Chris, by the way, was in Terminator 3. A lot of folks don't know. That's Range, by the way, going from Singled Out to Terminator
3. That's right. I play Expositional Scientist number 2, and
he's at the end.
That's right. No, I'm in the middle. I get to explain. This is how I knew that it wasn't going to get cut, because I was explaining some stuff that you needed to know.
Right.
Well, why are the...
Right.
We don't know what's going on. And then there was a lot of technical jargon that I rattled off.
Chris, and are you doing stand-up now, by the way?
Yes, I'm doing stand-up solo, and then I tour with my best friend Mike Furman. We have this group called Hard and Firm.
And so back to Rock of Ages, you sing which numbers?
It's all 80, but it's not all hair metal, but it takes place in 86. So, you know, you've got your Whitesnake and your Poison, and but we also have, you know, Bon Jovi, Pat Benatar, you know, so any kind of lighter, shaking tune. But I sing some Styx. I sing a little bit of Bon Jovi. Sing a little bit of Whitesnake.
Which Styx did he do?
We do Too Much Time on My Hands. Yeah. And Tommy Shaw has actually been to the show twice. Like, every show you look out, and you're like, oh, I know that guy.
Well, doesn't he love musicals, or is that the other guy from Styx?
I think apparently it's Tommy Shaw, because he's been there twice.
Did he spearheaded the Mr. Roboto?
No, you're thinking of lead singer, can't recall his name.
Is that Tad's going to come in and tell us, by the way?
Here comes the 80s
Big Tad.
Music expert.
Yeah.
Here Tad. He is.
Dennis DeYoung. Yes. That is Now, he's a lead singer. Is he Styx, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, and he's
the one who insisted on the Mr. Roboto direction.
Yeah, that was my favorite behind the music, which was Styx, which was at the end. Dennis DeYoung wanted to go a new direction with the band. He was so enthralled with musical theater and telling a story that at a certain point, they're at some like rock festival in someplace deep in the panhandle of Texas with 60,000 drunken people out there. And he said, it's time to unveil a little something called Mr. Roboto.
Talk about a crowd that loves musical theater.
I know. And the band was like, are you high? We're going to get killed. We'll be raped with a Jack Daniels bottle. He's put on the robot outfit, fellas. We're doing it tonight. And Mr. Roboto, in context or with the context, is still horrible. Out of context, when you're loaded and it's 1986 and you're at a festival and your old lady's up on her shoulders and her shirt's over her head, has to be, but you must think you're hallucinating on peyote at this point.
You know what drunken topless ladies love? Songs about robots.
Yeah, it's weird.
True. They just love it. They love it. So if you want to see a girl's knobs, just start singing about robots.
So they're all like, we'll be killed if we go out there. They want to hear the old stuff. They want to hear the rock. Let's just rock. They're loaded. We're headlining this band. No, put on the robot outfits. We're going out. So they went out there and were like booed off stage.
I got to say though, Tommy Shaw, nice guy. And not once did robots come up in our conversation.
Imagine guys with like three stage mullets wearing the camouflage hunting hats and a sleeveless shirt that says bad to the bone with the Rottweilers
yes,
on it.
Yes, yes.
And they're watching this.
What the F, I think, might have been.
F, it's going. Cigarettes just dangling.
Stringy mustache.
That look where the hat moves up on its own. What the hell?
Some big leather jacket that says 357 Magnum. Why run? You'll just die tired. They don't want to hear about robots.
The hell is a robot? Who the hell is Kilroy? He's like, even if he was singing about having sex with his robot lady, I would not be into this. All right, we need to take a little break. Chris Hardwick is in. The name of the show is Rock of Ages. And we'll be right back after that.
It's the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam Carolla now, 866-901-ADAM.
Yes. 866-901-ADAM. Chris Hardwick is here. Chris from Rock of Ages, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday.
Yeah, seriously.
Hollywood Theater, yes.
All the shows have been sold out so far. They just released some more tickets for this weekend. There's two weekends left. And, I mean, if you like 80s rock, there's like 30 people in the cast and lady dancers and lights and a band, and the show will probably impregnate you. It's amazing. It'll punch your nuts and impregnate you.
Wow.
That's right.
You have nuts and
you're going to get them. That's how awesome the show is. You see what I'm saying?
Talk about range. Let's hear. We were talking during the break about some horrible 80s songs. We happen to have a few of them. Mike, give us a little sample. Surprise me. Something on my horrible list.
Oh, that's from Karate Kid.
Well, you're done, the best.
That's the winning montage.
The montage is climb to fighting Johnny.
Where
we can
believe that a kid who trains karate for a month beats people who were raised in a dojo.
I like. All right, let's all settle it. Best. I like the line too that they were just doing every 80s song. The history repeats itself. History repeats itself. This is the first tournament the guy has entered himself in. What history party? Is it long history with mixed martial arts? It's the first time he ever met Miyagi. It's the first time he's ever entered the All-Valley.
I can
karate
that
tournament.
Song is not in Rock of Ages.
It is
another reason to go.
Let's hear another song that may not
be
in Rock of
Ages. Do you have
Ages?
Stan Bush's You've Got the Touch?
That's a good one.
You've got the power!
Yeah. Or Robert Palmer. This is a horrible, horrible Robert Palmer song. I'm sad that Robert Palmer is gone, just on a human level, but musically, it was a windfall for all of us who love music.
Not really, because I'm still hearing this song. So
well, that's a good point.
Robert Palmer may have passed away, but the song lives on,
my
friend.
They didn't have the guitar girls on a Super Bowl ad for Lost, too. A Bad Case of Loving You is a horrible... Any of those sort of 80s doctor songs where you're infected by the other person's love. Yeah, that's called Pink Eye. Stop singing about it. What else do we have? Oh.
I don't know why you want to mess with Hall & Oates. I like Hall & Oates.
Yeah, but let's really. A lot of folks defend this song, and they defend Hall & Oates because they go, oh, come on, Rich Girl and Sarah Smile, those are great songs. Yeah, those are great songs. Those aren't Maneater, you understand?
It's true.
Right, even the great number 7, Big Ben, can throw a pick.
Throws an errant ball.
And that's what this one is. This is him trying to hit an out pattern and a DB just closing the window and taking it to the house. That's what this is the equivalent of for Holland S. Yes, I've changed your name to Holland S.
Holland S. That sounds like a janitor.
Holland S. People defend this song, too.
But there was a big cat in the video. What else do you want?
It's the worst song ever made.
Man, I don't think you're listening, Adam. He's warning you about a very dangerous woman.
I know.
Who is going to chew you up and spit you out emotionally. What is the problem?
A lot of 80s songs about warning you about these women who are cat-like gypsy women.
This song is an adult version of One to Grow On, all right?
Yes.
This song is a warning.
Yes, yes. I will play this song for my young children when they're old enough to know. Yes.
He's so frightened that he shouts out, he exclaims, whoa, here she comes.
Well, it's not, and if you just listen, I'm ready for love, but she's not going to be there for it. So it's a warning.
Watch out, fellas.
I think this song would have been great if it had had like an air raid siren in it.
How about this? Here's what I would have compromised with. I appreciate the watch out, boys, the heads up for the Maneater. How about Hall & Oates, you give us a heads up when you're going to write the world's worst song. How about 3 months before this, you write, whoa, whoa, watch out, radio listeners. Here comes the world's crappiest song. She'll chew you. Here's the deal. If you guys had written a song about paying off program directors with mounds of cocaine and then writing the world's worst song and then having it rammed up our tuchus so it goes to number 1 in this country, that's what I needed the warning for. Tukai! That's what I needed the heads up for, not the Maneater. Because what are the chances I'm going to meet this chick?
Also, Maneater will not be appearing in the musical Rock of Ages.
Good, good.
Which you can buy tickets at rockofagesmusical.com.
What other?
I'm shilling my wares.
No, you should because I'm off on a tangent.
That's all right. But that's what I love about you, Adam Carolla.
I hate that song. Is there another song that I know we're out of time, but one more song that we might not hear in Rock of Ages? Little Brian Adams for you.
I just hear the song and all I can is the point of view of the arrow hitting the tree.
Yes.
In Robin Hood.
Robin Hood. People forget about that movie.
I wonder why.
Because,
I had forgotten about it until just now. Thanks, guys.
All right. Let's not have a flashback. Chris is having post-traumatic stress disorder.
Don't tell me.
You can just hear sorority nipples hardening.
Yes.
Whenever the song comes on.
That was me, by the way. That wasn't a sorority nipple. Chris Hardwick, Rock of Ages.
Yes.
Rockofagesmusical.com.
80s hair metal. Check it out. Dancers, ladies, fun, bands. It's good.
Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Tickets available.
Just a few, though, so call them.
Yeah, rockofagesmusical.com. Thanks, Chris.
Thanks, Adam Carolla.
Deaf Frat Guy coming in here. We'll have some news. We'll have some sports. All that.
You're listening to the new Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM.
That's right. 866-901-ADAM. Deaf Frat Guy is back in studio.
What's up, bro?
Hold on a second there, Deaf Frat Guy. John?
Yeah.
You're Bruska's friend. You're in Brooklyn.
Yeah. Unfortunately.
You got the wallet back from the woman who picked up the wallet and called us, right?
Yeah, I gave them $40 for lunch because they're really nice girls and they run a daycare center here.
Okay. Well, thank you. Thank you.
I have to tell you this. One of the girls who's her coworker is from Brooklyn, and she said she wouldn't have returned the wallet.
Right. We had so we're as almost 0-3 in Bruska's hometown of Brooklyn.
For Brooklyn-born people, not for L.A.-born people.
Right. We had, thank you, John, we had the one person that did return the wallet, except for that person was formerly from Rancho Cucamonga, so Southern California. All right, now, Deaf Frat Guy is here. His name is Jason. The folks in his house call him Maverick, and I think he's a Sammy, right? Is that your fraternity?
Dude, why you got to do me like that, bro? I'm a tink. I told you that a million times.
I'm sorry.
Now you're just dissing me.
I'm sorry. I know. It's always funny when people do that, like, inside the world, you know, but outside the world, there's no difference between a teak and a Sammy, but if you're a Sammy and someone calls you a teak, you're outraged and vice versa, yes?
That fat frat guy's almost lunging across the table
at you. He's angry.
Look, if I had a potato gun, your house would have a bunch of broken windows.
Yeah. And you're, you know, that, again, it's one of those frat things, the potato gun.
The Sammy house is really cool. If you like to see a house covered in pumpkins and toilet paper.
That's good stuff. And you guys, you're fifth year senior over at SC. You'll be graduating this year.
I soon graduate, but I love college life.
Mm-hmm. What's your major?
Communication.
Okay.
Right now, but I'm thinking to switch to hotel and restaurant management. I think it would be really cool to be a concierge.
Right. Yeah, that'd be good for you.
Well, let's try that out. Hey, I'm going to go over to the beach later on today. Is there a restaurant I might like?
There's a place where you can get 2-for-1 well drinks.
But see, Deaf Rat Guy, I know you're in a culture that drinks a lot, but I think when, like, a couple is looking for a nice restaurant, it's not all about Jello shots and shooters, you know? They probably want to know about the meal.
Dude, Ashley and Smitty broke up because they went out to a restaurant, did a bunch of Jello shots, went back to his dorm room, and he tried to do the Regal Beagle with her.
which Ashley are we talking about?
Not the try-down, actually, but the one who was shaved down below.
You say your private parts are shaved.
Yeah, that too.
Oh, yeah. All right, so now you were going to do a little... Rachel Perry, by the way, is in New York for Fashion Week. She is going to be doing the news very shortly, but Deaf Rat Guy... As Jason or Maverick, as he's known, you watched a game yesterday with all your frat buddies on the big screen. Did you hang there exclusively?
The end of the third quarter, I went up to my room. Sometimes I get a little bummed out about my hearing.
Something funny about that, Dave?
No, I don't know why. I feel bad about it. I'm sorry.
Okay, now frat guy, Deaf Rat Guy was going to read from the Star Jones book for us. We have many of the people that come on the show do the reading from the Star Jones book. Maybe we should add Ozzy's name to that list too next time he comes in here. But we thought it'd be fun to have Deaf Rat Guy read a package from Shine, the Star Jones book. Are you prepared, Deaf Rat Guy?
Hell yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, here we go.
Page 210, Passion. Let me say a few words about passion before I start talking about sex and dating in a moral friendship. I mean, relationship. My man, he's passionate. He was when we were dating, and he never stopped. But passion has to be something more than sex. You can have a passion for growing roses, for painting, for exuberance in life.
For what in life? I'm sorry.
Exuberance.
Okay.
Al is passionate about some textures. He loves the feel of cashmere. For first Christmas, my mother bought him a gray cashmere sweater out of the blue.
Whoa.
She didn't know about his passion.
He's passionate about textures.
Al puts on that sweater and his pajama bottom, and it's like a cocoon for him.
So gay-coon, you mean.
So passion maybe is finding the thing the other loves and being willing to give it to him. And passion is being each other's cheerleader. Mm. Speaking of cheerleaders, there's this new transfer student who's a tryout. I wouldn't mind doing a regal beagle with her.
Oh yeah, you had for. Are you seeing anybody, or are you exclusive?
Right now, I'm playing the field. Why buy the cow when the milk is free?
I realized when I called Al Reynolds a gay coon, it probably sounded a little worse than I'd actually meant. If you really think about it, it was sort of based on the cuckoon. Needs a context, you know. Gay coon is really probably something. Sounds a lot worse than even I intended, yes? All right. Well, nice job, Def Frat Guy.
One more thing. I forgot to tell you, Josh Blair got his stomach pumped.
Oh, really? Drank too many Jello shots at the Super Bowl party?
Hell yeah.
All right, well, you guys take it easy. Remember, you got to do some studying at college, too.
Work hard, play hard, not... College is all about partying and having a good time.
All right, Deaf Rat Guy, thank you for coming by.
He turned that cliche on its ear, ironically, his deaf ear. He turns a deaf ear to that noise.
All right, late.
Late, dude. Right. See you, guy, dude, bro. All right, now, Rachel Perry from New York with the news.
I wish I was there. Well, President Bush sent a $2.77 trillion budget to Congress looking to increase the military and cut other government programs. Four men are dead in Afghanistan as protests over this cartoon depictions of the Prophet Muhammad continue. 18-year-old Jacob Robida, suspected of an attack in a Massachusetts gay bar, was killed by police after a car chase and shootout in Arkansas, but not before killing a police officer and his 33-year-old passenger.
The 33-year-old passenger, Rachel Perry,
yeah.
Do you think she was abducted? I mean, they're calling her a passenger. But you mean you think she was a hostage, or is it like the guy's friend? I mean,
well, a couple of apparently Jacob Robida's friends that he knows from MySpace.com say that the passenger was actually his girlfriend.
Mm.
But I don't know if you can trust anyone from MySpace.
Well, we'll figure out later on this week on 48 Hours or 2020 when they interview his red-faced, bucket-headed, tight puka shell, greasy bang, blonde haired buddy who looks like one of Tad's friends from 20 years ago. And he explains that he never thought this guy was capable of it, even though we knew he had the Nazi flag hanging and made a lot in tortured animals.
Yeah,
and then, and we'll see him indifferent about it.
Yeah, we're going to miss him.
Okay, good. I'm glad he's dead.
There's a worldwide manhunt for Al-Qaeda mastermind behind the bombing of the USS Cole in 2000 that killed 17 sailors.
Mm. Kill him, too.
Yeah. If we find him.
Well, here's the whole thing. All the guys who, whether it's Al-Qaeda members or just guys who are in local jails, once they escape, this is your chance to shoot them, everybody. You see what I'm saying? We have to drag these guys back in. We have to put them through the court system. It's going to cost taxpayers money. We have to give these guys three hots and a cot. Now that they're on the escape, I've seen enough movies. You shoot them. That's what you do. You don't bring them back. You just shoot them, and nobody knows what went on. He made a move for his gun, and I shot him. That's what you do. Even if a guy breaks out of the drunk tank, as soon as he gets out, you just shoot him. That's it. You don't have to drag him back, and no questions are asked. Thank you.
Vigilante justice.
That's right.
As far as I'm concerned.
That's right.
The woman who got the world's first partial face transplant showed herself to the media for the first time, saying now she has a face like everyone else. I can't stop staring at these pictures.
Yeah. Well, she looks like she's had some work done, but she doesn't look as bad as Melanie Griffith. Or is it Griffin or Griffith?
And that's a burn.
Yeah.
Sheryl Crow and Lance Armstrong broke up, even though they were supposed to get married.
Mm.
You hear about that?
Yeah, I told my wife he cheated. Anytime a celebrity couple breaks up, I always say the guy cheated. It makes me look better.
That's exactly right.
That's the way I do.
Well played, sir.
Yeah.
And the Rolling Stones, of course. Do we have time for this? I don't know. I kind of want to let Dave get, have his day, talk about sports.
They were an apocalypse. Mm. Yeah. By the way, the excuse that people make for them is, hey, they're still having fun. They're guys in their 60s, and they still love playing their music.
Yeah.
So what? Why is that allowable? Because they enjoy it. It's torturous for the rest of us.
Why should we be punished?
Right. If a surgeon is 87 years old, and he said, but I still love to do surgery, doesn't mean that you still let him into the OR to cut on
but
you.
But it's his passion. Come on. He hasn't stopped having fun yet.
I thought the pregame show was better than the halftime show.
Well, here's a news flash for everybody. The Stones aren't a great band anymore. I don't even know if they ever were. 30 years ago, they had some good songs. They haven't had a good song in 30 years. I don't know why people are into them. They always sound like there's a couple of band members who are missing whenever I see them playing live. And it's no surprise to me that they weren't great yesterday. They haven't been great for a long time, and they haven't had a good song in a long time.
I feel like watching them is the way I was staring at them the way I stare at the face transplant lady.
Yes.
What's going to happen? Anyway, you know what? I'm just going to let Dave talk about the Super Bowl. You have your day, sir.
Have your day in the sun,
I'm
Dave
Rachel
Damage
Perry, and that is the news for now.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
Day in the sun? Nay. My lifetime is now hereby made. By the events in Detroit yesterday, Super Bowl 40, Pittsburgh Steelers defeat the Seattle Seahawks 21-10. Hines Ward is your MVP.
What is his nationality?
Hines?
Yes.
He's mixed.
What is it?
I think he has a GI father and an Asian mother.
So it's kind of Tiger Woodsy.
Right. I think they met, okay. I'm not sure where they met. I'm not going to conjecture.
He's Korean.
All I know is that he's dynamite.
Well, let's find out.
Now, very quickly, I will mention this because it's my job. NBA last night, Los Angeles' favorite NBA team, the LA Clippers. Two overtimes, they defeat the Raptors. They're now 11 games over 500 for the first time since they became the Clippers.
Wow.
Also, the Kings of Shorts and Ento whipped Utah last night. But back to Super Bowl 40. First of all, on a personal note, this completes my run through the postseason. I defy you to name any supposed expert, some prognosticator. I went 11-0 picking against the point spread this postseason.
That frat guy said Smitty in his house went 11-0.
No, impossible. 11-0
That's what he said.
I
didn't want to call the guy a liar.
11-0
He said he went 11-0, and I said against the spread, and he said, yeah.
Sonny Junkhead and Slappy.
Wow, Junkhead and Slappy.
Wow.
What year is your frat house in, by the way? 1953? Junkhead and Slappy. All right, 11-0 is impressive, especially against the spread. It's amazing.
I would like to be hailed, but it's not about me.
If you go 11-0 on a parlay card, you're going to get 500-1.
Well, we figured it out that had I bet $20 on every game and let it ride after each game, I would have won $250,000 if I would have made this.
And you didn't? Oh.
It's not about that, Adam. It's about what happened in the Super Bowl yesterday.
Well, what happened?
The Pittsburgh Steelers have returned to their rightful place as rulers of the football globe.
Wow.
That's right.
Over the globe.
Now, the guy who they've been talking about a great deal the last couple of weeks is Jerome Bettis, who, if I heard correctly yesterday, is from the city of Detroit.
I did not know that.
Right.
Hadn't heard that.
It was a lot of conjecture. He's been in the league for 13 years, and here's what he said up on the podium just moments after the game.
You know what? It's been an incredible ride, and it's always a time when you have to call it quits, and I played this game to win a championship. I'm a champion. And I think the bus is, the last stop is here in Detroit.
Yes.
He's
hanging it up.
He looked fatter than ever. There was one shot where he was profile in those, here's the thing. If he's out on the street, he should be wearing an enormous sweatsuit, not silk tights and a tucked in shirt. But he turned profile at a certain point, and there was a good from his belly to his ass was 33 inches. I mean, not around, just straight across. I mean, he looked He just, I don't know what he's listed at. 240-something, 250-something. He has to be almost 300 pounds.
He may be over 300 pounds, but let me tell you something. You can fire all the mean-spirited bullets you want at him, but he's a man of steel. Here's what he said.
I'm just saying enjoy him because he's going to stroke out in the next 18 months. He's going to balloon up to 700 pounds and die of a stroke.
But before that, as happy as I am to be back here with you in sunny L.A., it sounds like there are going to be some good times coming. Here's what the bus said also yesterday.
It feels incredible. I mean, my teammates, you know, they put me on their backs and they made sure that they wouldn't let me down every step of the way. These guys were tremendous. I mean, they just, they brought it home for us. And Detroit, you were incredible. Pittsburgh, here we come.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. And then, of course, I was up on the podium as well. And
oh, were
what,
you?
Yeah, here's what I had to say.
Hey, we're a close-knit team. We're all thrilled.
Crowded,
you know,
emptied a little bit
Hines
after.
And Rome and Ben and everyone else, you know, we're just, you know, we all gave 110%. You know, everyone made a contribution today. Man, the fans, it was a great support. Great, you know, it's great to see those terrible towels waving. And, hey, those Seahawks.
I appreciate the fans.
A great effort.
I don't want anybody to think I forgot them.
To hang their heads about. But, hey, we're bringing that Super Bowl trophy back to Pittsburgh where it belongs.
See? But here's the thing also I want to say, because I want to take some time to pay homage to the Seahawks, because, mm-hmm. you know, like Jerry Orbach at the end of Dirty Dancing,
yeah.
he says to Swayze, I take my cues from Jerry Orbach. I don't like to apologize if I don't have to, but mm-hmm. when I'm wrong, I say I'm wrong. Mm-hmm. And I was wrong about one thing, those Seattle Seahawks uniforms. In person, that all blue, striking, a
really?
Handsome outfit. You know I disparaged it to no end.
Yes, to no end.
But they look very good. But speaking of Swayze.
Takes a big man.
I also, now that I finally, a lot of people thought, oh, Dave, you'll be unbearable if the Steelers actually get over the top. Untrue. I'm finally now at peace.
Mm-hmm.
I'm released. All my unresolved issues are gone. I'm now like Swayze at the end of Ghost. Rising up into the heavens. Mm-hmm. The clouds have opened. I bid you all good day.
Yeah, so it's like Point Break when you finally caught the perfect wave.
Yes.
And now your body casts
you know,
to the sea.
I just have to say, I don't know what I did to deserve this life. But let me tell you, yesterday, I spend the weekend in Detroit. You know, it's Super Bowl. I have seats at the 50-yard line provided to me by the mensch of mensches, Jimmy Kimmel. He gives me his tickets. He can't go. He could have given them to any number of celebrities. But mm-hmm. no, he says, Dave, I want you to go because it's where you belong. Mm-hmm. And I say, here, here, Kimmel. Mm-hmm. Then I sit there. I watch the game seated next to Jessica Alba. The
Beautiful.
Whole game. I watch the Steelers win the Super Bowl. Alba's along for the ride. Then afterwards, I run over to Jimmy Kimmel Live, just mm-hmm. literally half hour after
Cross the street.
The Steelers are anointed.
Mm-hmm.
And who do I get to glad hand with? Jerome Bettis and Antoine Randolo.
Wow.
We kibitzed, we talked, we shed some tears together, we embraced,
mm-hmm.
we talked about the good times, we thought about the bad times, the rough patches we'd been through.
When Antoine Randall described meeting you, do you think he used kibitz?
Listen, keep up with the mean-spirited bullets. I'm impregnable as well.
All right. And the big party starts in a couple days, probably in Pittsburgh. Although I did hear they overturned a few cars, which is why whenever the Lakers would win the championship, we would always flip our car over so that when the marauding horde hit our house, they would upright it. The joke was on them. It was tough. Me and my dad would always have to roll the Buick Regal over on its roof, but we would leave it out in the street, and oftentimes it would be put back up onto its four wheels.
Well, I'll just close with this. You know, the day after the Super Bowl, the birth of a whole new day for me, you know, lifetime for me. I did disparage the Rolling Stones earlier, but this they did play this song as a celebration, and I thought it was terrific. This is Mick
better
Jagger. You don't
Stones.
Even hear his accent.
No. I know, it's funny, but it's better than the Stones.
What are you talking about? Again? Every day.
Yes.
I have it on a loop in my home.
Is this ever going to end? I just mean the constant talking about the Steelers. When is it going to end?
Never, baby doll. Never. Machinery humming.
All right. Steeler machinery humming?
That's right.
Wow. All right. Dave Damashek with sports, are you?
Dave Damashek's number one sports.
All right. We doing that Howard Cosell thing?
Yeah, Cosell's here.
Oh, Howard Cosell is here.
Back from the dead. And I'd like if the Def Rat guy could stick around, maybe play some Ass Kiss Rodeo.
Do you know how to play Ass Kiss Rodeo, Def Rat guy?
Hell yeah, bro. I read the transcripts on the show every day.
Wow, so you're online. Beautiful. So hang out, Howard Cosell, and more Def Rat guy with a little Ass Kiss Rodeo after this.
It's the Iceman, Chuck Liddell. Call Adam Carolla now at 1-866-901-ADAM. If you don't, I'll beat your ass.
Yes, he will. 866-901-ADAM. Now, here's why we need you to call in, because we're going to do some gambling on this show, and I will play for you if you call in to my show. We have $100 worth of Hooters gift certificate to give you. I will play Dave Damashek in a little sports game. We're going to do Def Rat Guy reading from, I shouldn't say reading, but playing a little Ass Kiss Rodeo, but first, let me set this up. Football season over, and even though Sheck is euphoric about it, still a big letdown. Sad.
Sure.
The football season is over. I don't want it to end. I need something to replace it. I figured out that Monday Night Football has been going on since 1970. I have no idea who won any of the games prior to this season. You really could go back two seasons. I wouldn't know any of them. I mean, you would know if the Steelers were playing somebody, but just any random Monday night game in 2002, you probably wouldn't know who ended up winning unless it was the Patriots playing the Browns. So I decided, why not gamble on games that have already taken place? I don't know the answer, and neither does Sheck, and we both haven't looked up anything. So we're going to go through the 1970 first season of Monday Night Football and gamble on the games. And if I win, you're getting yourself a Hooters gift certificate for $100. And if Sheck wins, well, he's 11-0. And like I said, the...
I already have a bounty of riches, yes.
Yes. All right. But first, we were going to play a little Ass Kiss Rodeo with Def Rat Guy. This is basically me...
What's up, bro?
What's happening, Jason? It's Jason, right?
It's all good.
Okay.
My tag at the house is Maverick.
Oh, right, right. That's your tag, right?
But you're such a great guy. You can call me anything you want.
Right, right. Your job is to kiss my ass, and I see if I can buck you off by changing my mind. And a little something we call Ass Kiss Rodeo.
It's Ass Kiss Rodeo.
Woo-hoo!
Man, do I love beer.
Of course you do, bro. We have a beer drinking game in our house. One bro says Adam, and the other say Carolla, and the last guy to say Carolla has to drink.
Wow, what an honor. But I don't know how I feel about drinking on campus. If I was in charge, it'd all be dry campuses.
Well, I can see your point, maybe. But
I know you have a handicap, right, Def Rat Guy. But
I'm trying to read the screen.
But the other thing is we like to treat you as an equal, you know? This isn't the Special Olympics of Ass Kiss Rodeo. Although, write that down, Preska. Why shouldn't those people get a chance to compete?
It's really cool that you thought of the idea of a dry campus. I thought of that, too. I guess great minds think alike.
All right, well, a day late,
little late,
dollar
but,
but solid, solid.
Adam, no matter what you say, I agree. Everything you do is genius.
Thanks, Def Frat Guy. Leo?
Yeah.
You want me to play for you?
Yeah, man. I 1970s, I think you got it.
Well, there are 12 games.
Okay.
And I guess there are only 12 games in the season.
Okay.
In 1970. So we're going to go through those games from the first season of Monday Night Football. Obviously, we have no idea who won. So let's get this started. I'll gamble against Sheck. Again, he's 11-0 against the spread. Amazing.
I'm a seer.
Like I said, if you have a parlay card in Vegas and you decide to go with an 11-team parlay and you bet $100, you probably get a couple hundred grand. Right. I don't know if it's that high, but it's up there.
Not unlike my football team that now resides once again atop the football world. I am king of the football gambling mountain.
Though. Well, let's see. Let's see if you can remain on your rocky throne. You ready? Here we go.
The first Monday night football game ever. Joe Namath and the New York Jets head to Cleveland to take on Bill Nelson-led Cleveland Browns.
Hmm. Well, I think we both know the answer to this. Do we not, Shaq?
To be honest with you, I don't.
Oh, you don't?
I'm going to go with the Jets.
You say the Jets?
Yes.
All right. Well, I know the answer, so I'll say the Cleveland Browns.
Namath throws for 3 interceptions. The Browns hold off the Jets for a 31-21 victory.
Dang.
It's funny that I made an example moments earlier about not even knowing who won the game in last year's Monday Night Football. We now went back 36 years and I knew who won the game. It's the famous picture of Namath on his knees at the end of the game.
Is that
sort
right?
Of
yeah.
looking down and looking like all the life has been taken out of it.
I didn't know that.
All right, I'm sorry. It still counts as a win. You took the Jets. Here we go, next game.
Quarterback Len Dawson and the Chiefs head to Baltimore to take on Earl Morrell and the Colts, coached by Don McCafferty.
I'm going to go Colts.
Yes, Colts.
Colts.
Lee Dawson throws 4 touchdown passes. Wow. The Chiefs knock off the Colts 44-24.
Lenny Dawson. So,
by the way, can I say what a thrill it is to
be next to the great Howard Cosell?
Working with Howard Cosell. What a thrill.
So, 0-2 goes Shaq. 1-1 goes the Ace Man and his partner Leo. Leo, how say you?
Oh, I like you. I like what you're doing.
All right, next game. Howard.
Next game, the powerful Bears defense led by Dick Butkus travel north to face quarterback Bill Munson and the Detroit Lions.
Wow, the famous, the legendary Billy Munson. Household name. Rachel Perry, big Munson fan?
Huge Munson fan. I love that TV show.
All right. Shaq, how say you?
Well, that doesn't sound like a very good game, but I'll go with the Bears. I'm going to go with the Bears, I guess.
Who are they playing?
Lions.
Lions. Oh, I'll go Lions. What the heck?
The Lions explode for 21 points in the third quarter to defeat the Bears 28-14.
Wow. You got to recalibrate your divining rod, Shaq. 11-0 in real time, but everyone knows the mark of a great gambler is gambling on games that already took place.
4 decades ago.
And
right?
It's not just games. It's horse races. It's everything. World events.
All right, I'm going to focus now. I gave you a little handicap.
0-3.
I gave you a little lead.
All right, next game.
Quarterback Bart Starr and the Green Bay Packers head west to take on the Charlie Waller coach San Diego Chargers.
How say you, Shaq?
Again, 1970. It's weird. Obviously, Lombardi has moved on, and they're on their way down. I guess I'll take a shot on the Chargers.
Yeah, I'm going Chargers, too, on this one.
The Packers record 6 sacks and register 4 interceptions to hold off the Chargers 22-20.
0-4 goes Shaq on this. One more game, Jesus. And then we're going to break.
John Madden's Oakland Raiders play host to the Washington Redskins, coached by Bill Austin.
Redskins.
Redskins have yet to achieve prominence under George Allen. I'm going to go with John Madden.
I'm going Skins just to make it a game.
Kira Dixon posts best performance in 2 years with 164 rushing yards to lead the Raiders to a 34-20 victory.
On the board.
Right back in now. 1-4 goes Shaq. What's the Ace Man, as I lovingly call myself, Brusca?
2-4.
Yeah, yeah.
2-3.
Well, Ace Man's got 2 correct. Dave's got 1 through 5 games.
Wow. I'm only up by 1 after all that dominance. Feel a lot like the Seahawks. Feel like I went up and down the field all day, but we go into the locker room, 7-3.
Just like yesterday, the second half of this, I will emerge victorious.
All right. We'll take ourselves a quick break. Let me check back in with Leo. Leo?
Yep.
All right, I'm still 1 up, brother.
That sounds good. I like it. You had to go with Oakland, man. You got to go with John Madden.
I know. You're right. Sorry. Hang tight. We'll be right back after this.
You're listening to The Adam Carolla Show. He's so hot.
All right, little more show to go, so we got to hurry because we got a lot more show to stuff into it. Leo?
Yep.
All right, buddy, I'm playing for you.
All right, man. We're doing. I still got faith in you, man.
We're doing retro Monday Night Football. Even though the season's over, I want to continue gambling. And no better way than to actually go over the Monday Night Football games in order and gamble on them. Because I have no idea who won the 1970 game between the Broncos.
Because you're depressed. You're depressed. Football's over, but this is
it's my methadone.
The dog that bit you, right?
That's right. All right. Now, Sheck was 1 out of 5. I was 2 out of 5. And we continue with the great Howard Cosell.
Gary Kroso and the Minnesota Vikings head to rainy Southern California to face quarterback Roman Gabriel and the Los Angeles Rams.
I'll go Vikings.
I'll go Rams.
Vikings defense holds the Rams to 100 total yards. Vikings win 13-3.
They went to the Super Bowl that year. That's why I picked them.
Rams can't even win in the past. Wow. Sad. All right, now we're tied up, yes?
The Paul Brown-coached Cincinnati Bengals are set to take on quarterback Terry Hanratty and the Pittsburgh Steelers at Three Rivers Stadium.
Well, obviously I'm taking the Steelers, but the Cincinnati, this must be their first year. They must have stunk.
Yeah, I'm going to go with the Steelers as well.
Hanratty throws for 2 touchdowns in the fourth, lifting the Steelers over the Bengals 21-10.
Damashek heating up 3 in a row now.
His dad and mom both have the Hanratty jersey. I see him wearing around. Diehard Steeler fans. All right, so now we're both 3 out of 7?
Correct.
Something like that?
Yes.
All right.
Coach Don McCaffrey and his Baltimore Colts look for their 6th straight victory when they face the Green Bay Packers, led by Bart Starr.
I say the Colts took care of business.
I'm going to go with the Packers.
Colts register 4 interceptions and hold off a late surge by the Packers en route to their 6th straight victory, 13-10.
Just as the Steelers made their late charge in the season.
Late charge. Now up on me and Leo by 1 game. Yes, Leo?
Yes, sir.
I know. You can feel that Hooters gift certificate slipping away.
I'm ruthless.
And hang on. Let's keep going.
St. Louis Cardinals head to Dallas to take on the Cowboys, coached by Tom Landry.
Cowboys.
I'm going Cowboys on this one.
The Cardinals defense proved to be too much for the Cowboys, stopping them twice within the 10-yard line. The Cardinals record their 3rd consecutive shutout, 38-0.
Shocker.
Wow. See, that's us. We didn't know the Cardinals were good. They're so bad now. All right, where are we now? How many more games do we have left?
One more?
Let's go all the way through the season and play
team. Oh, I'm sorry.
Quarterback Fran Tarkenton and the New York Giants play host to the Norman Snead and the Philadelphia Eagles.
Giants.
Yeah, I'm going Eagles just to try to get back in it.
A 1-yard sneak by Eagles quarterback Norman Snead early in the fourth proved to be the difference in this game. The Eagles win 23-20, snapping New York's 6-game winning streak.
Wow. And they're tied. Leo back in it.
All locked up. How many more games do we have left now? 2 games? Yes. All right, two games.
You may see those legs covered in pantyhose yet.
Tied up.
Hooters.
Tied up 4-4.
Here we go.
Don Shula's Miami Dolphins hit the road to face and the Norm Van Brocklin coached Atlanta Falcons.
Well, I got to go Miami on this one.
I agree.
Dolphins running back Larry Csonka rushes for 108 yards to lead the Dolphins to their 7th victory on the season, 20-7.
All right, last game. Now, somebody, we're just going to have to pick against each other.
Right.
All right, I'll go
first.
In
the final Monday Night Football game of the season, the Bill Munson-led Detroit Lions faced the Los Angeles Raiders, coached by John Madden.
I'm going Raiders. Come on, man.
The Raiders post 17 points in the fourth quarter, but come up short as they fall to the Lions, 28-20.
A winner again.
Wow, Shaq won.
Everything I touch turns to gold. Nay, black and gold. A champion again.
Damn it.
Leo, I'm sorry. You know, I picked against Madden earlier season, man. And I lost twice on Madden.
Man.
Sorry, brother. Sorry. All right. Well, there you go. We're going to have to keep that Hooters gift certificate. And, Check's going to order, eat $100 worth of hot wings after the show. What a roll he's on. Tomorrow, Jorge Garcia, Hurley from Lost, heavyset man from Lost. Good guy's going to be in here. Also, a lot of Grammys talk. I want to thank Elise Eberwein for calling in from U.S. Airways. She should be thanking me, by the way. Going to save her airline millions of dollars. Chris Hardwick from Rock of Ages over at the Vanguard Theater in Hollywood, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. Also, Jason the Maverick, also known as the Deaf Frat Guy, for coming in and doing a great job. Now, is he a Sammy?
I think he said Teak. He got upset about Teak.
That's right. Of course, my brother Oswaldo and Bill Cott is the great Howard Cosell. And until next time, this is Adam Carolla saying mahalo.
Please welcome Adam Carolla.
Here's the deal. I dig Portland, and I want to come to Portland. I mean, let's be honest. Somebody wants you to come out to Flagstaff.
Right.
Open a mighty muffler.
Yeah.
And it's like, yeah, I don't know. But Portland is cool. Portland's nice. Well, I'd love to come to Portland.
The Marconi Show. Afternoons. KUFO.
Adam Carolla here for Vermont Teddy Bear, the Pajamagram. So, first they conquered the world with the teddy bears. Now they're going to conquer the world with the PJs, the jammies. I like the ones with the flap in the back. Yeah. They're not just for the kids. They're for older drunk people, too, that flap in the back. A Pajamagram is a great gift. You'll receive the best pajamas or lingerie. It'll be delivered in a hat box, and the women love it. Anything that comes in a hat box, except for a hat, ironically, women love. Lavender has a lavender sachet in it, which I guess smells good, and I hope I'm pronouncing it right. Yep. You get the do not disturb sign for the door because you and your ladies are making a sweet whoopee. Inevitable. Shop online at pajamagram.com or call 1-800-GIVE-PJs. Again, 1-800-GIVE-PJs. And tell them Adam Carolla sent you. You want to shop online? You want to go to pajamagram.com. Or call 1-800-GIVE-PJs. This is where you get the Pajamagrams. Chicks love pajamas. My wife was born in the pajamas last night. I don't know why. It was hot, but yet she donned the PJs. And it looked nice. It's a nice little package. 1-800-GIVE-PJs. Women want to be pampered. I'm tired this morning. I got to be honest with you. Whoever's paying for this, give them their money back, Breska. Dig in your own pocket. Give the Pajamagram people their money back. They don't even need me to advertise. People know. People know women love pajamas. And guys know you can get a Pajamagram by calling 1-800-GIVE-PJs. Valentine's Day is right around the corner, and delivery is guaranteed if you hurry up and call 1-800-GIVE-PJs or visit pajamagram.com right now. That's pajamagram.com and tell them Adam Carolla sent you.
Don't wait.
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 Carolla sent you.
Don't wait.